Desert and the great American Southwest. I bid you all good evening or good morning, wherever you may be across this great land of ours. Westward, the Tahitian and Hawaiian Islands commercially, to the east, the Caribbean and U.S. Virgin Islands, south into South America, north all the way to the pole, and worldwide on ye olde internet. This is Coast to Coast AM. Good morning, everybody. I'm Art Bell. I've got a real oh my God moment for you in a moment with Richard C. Hoegland. You did not know he'd be here tonight, but here he is. And I'm telling you, when we get through this, it'll blow your mind. This is something you got to hear this first hour coming up. In our second hour, we're going to talk to Richard Roeper, who wrote a book called Urban Legends. You know what those are, right? And so we'll see of those what are true, and I guess by virtue of definition, if it's a legend, it's not true. So what's running around out there, and it certainly runs around the internet, oh boy, does it go around the internet. How many times have I heard about the guy in the bathtub with a hooker in Las Vegas missing a kidney in a bathtub of ice saying, call 911? Right? Those kinds of things. But coming up in a moment, what Richard has really is going to blow your mind. In the meantime, all glimmer of hope appears to be gone from the political scene, so I will return to my normal uncaring mode. In other words, Bush has absolutely swept the Super Tuesday primaries. Boom, 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 boom. And so he's looking for McCain to drop out. McCain's kind of a rebel. He might not, but it doesn't look too good right now. The Arizona senator did win four states, but none beyond the independent-minded New Englanders. On the Democrat side, all glimmer of hope is gone. Would I have preferred Bill Bradley to Al Gore? Oh, yes. Al Gore swept it, though. So that's all I have to say about that. Bush Gore. Now, on to more important things. Well, there is one more thing. In California, they have rejected by a very wide margin the concept of gay marriage. And they've done something that is kind of interesting, a ballot measure that would prohibit the state of California from recognizing same-sex marriages elsewhere. And I'm not sure they can do that legally, constitutionally. Maybe they can. Anyway, they've done it. Something else for a court, no doubt, somewhere to strike down. It's usually what happens when there's a ballot initiative in California, that the court comes along and strikes it down, and that's the end of that. We'll have to see what happens to this one. But prepare yourself, buckle in, because boy, have I got one for you in a minute here. How's your internet? You know, actually, every single one of my political expectation fears has come true. And it's down to Bush and Gore. So, in finality, when I said I wouldn't say it again, nevertheless, I say it again. Bush, Gore. Now, this is serious. This is very serious. What you're about to hear is very serious, and so you pay very close attention. Richard C. Hoegland wrote the book on Mars called The Monuments of Mars, and he wrote that how long ago, Richard?
Oh, almost 20 years ago.
Thank you. All right, let me continue. Now, 20 years ago, The Monuments of Mars. Richard C. Hoegland was at one time an advisor to NASA. He worked with Walter C. Cronkite. Hello there. Walter C. Cronkite. Daddy. The man everybody trusted more than anybody else in the world. Richard C. Hoegland won the Engstrom Science Award. He's been a regular guest on my show for how long do you figure, Richard?
Forever.
Forever. Mostly forever. So here he is, Richard C. Hoegland. And this is what's going on is just a blanking mind blower, as far as I'm concerned. A mission to Mars, we all know, is coming up, is going to debut on the 10th of this month.
Which is Friday.
Which is Friday.
Three days ago.
Is there a bunch of stuff going on about this movie. blanking believable is all I can say. Now, the movie was produced by Richard.
Well, Disney and Touchstone.
Yeah. And
Touchstone Pictures is a subsidiary of the Disney Corporation, the Disney family.
Yes, it is. On which stations I'm carried, by the way, as we jump into this.
Oh, they'll love this.
Yeah, they're going to love this. All right, so it's Disney, which uses Touchstone for movies mostly that it doesn't have Mickey Mouse and stuff, right?
Yep.
All right. Huh. So here comes Mission to Mars, and the man behind it, De Palma?
Brian De Palma.
Brian De Palma.
Eminent director, you know, has done all kinds of extraordinary award-winning great films of our time, a giant in the field, as they say, but has never done a, quote, science fiction film. And maybe he hasn't done one now.
Well put. Mr. De Palma is now and has been refusing all interviews with regard to the movie, right?
Well, this started Sunday night. The source that we're going to be quoting, which I do not want to name until Thursday night, because he's still digging for information, and I think that they will talk more freely if they don't hear his name bandied about on the Art Bell Show, has been providing us information based on a series of interviews that were conducted Sunday and Monday at the press junket where Disney Touchstone flies press from all over the country, television, international, print press, to Hollywood for special screenings of the film.
Yes.
And beginning Sunday night, my source has been giving me a kind of a running commentary on the increasing weird world of Disney. Not the wonderful world, but the weird world of Disney.
The weird world of Disney.
Because Brian De Palma, who has been, for 2 years now, shepherding this $120 million mega project, ranking up there with some of the most expensive films of all time.
Of all time, yeah. This is basically a movie about a mission to Mars and then losing contact with it and a second rescue mission going to Mars to get the first guys and find out what the hell's going on, basically.
That's right.
Right?
Yep. Anyway, the Sunday night of the print press preview, the print press premiere, De Palma suddenly, with absolutely no excuse, cancels all of his interviews. And has steadfastly, for over a week and a half now, refused to talk to anybody. In fact, one report coming out of Disney this afternoon said that the night following the premiere, he got on a plane and was in Europe somewhere.
What?
And this boggles the mind because one of the stories that came wrangling its way out of Disney in terms of an excuse was, well, he got ticked off at some of the reactions of some of the members of the press, and then decided he wasn't going to talk to anybody and you know, got out of Dodge.
Okay, they've been having some press previews, right?
Yeah, they've had a series.
For reviewers, that kind of
for function. The international press and the television press and the print press. These are the usual dog and pony shows where you, at great expense, fly in all these people.
Yep.
The Washington Times, it turns out, which never sends a reporter or an entertainment editor to cover these things, this time flew somebody in to Hollywood from Washington to cover this film, and when queried, the person who was going to cover it said, well, because it's NASA. And I might say parenthetically that the Washington Times has done some very favorable and positive stories on our research over the years, so I kind of pricked up at that.
All right, so NASA was, in fact, a consultant on this film, right?
More than a consultant. Again, our source, who is a nationally recognized entertainment writer, has been in the business for 14, 15 years, knows what he's doing.
Right.
He reported to me and submitted actual text of the transcript of the interview he conducted with Tom Jacobson, who is the producer of the film,
yes,
under Touchstone.
Right.
Part of four or five guys that got together 4 years ago and decided they were going to do something like this.
Right, right.
Jacobson not only confirms that NASA was intimately involved in the film from the get-go, but actually confirmed in print that NASA had script approval, that every single line in this film was supposed to have been vetted by the space agency before it was committed to film.
All right, now you listen.
So when I say
it's
on
very
our
important,
site,
folks, very important what you're hearing right now.
When I say on our site, you know, on Enterprise, in our coverage of this Mission to Mars film, that this is a NASA/Touchstone film, which I did several days ago, we have it confirmed from no less than the producer of the film itself that NASA was intimately involved in everything from script to technical advisors.
Well, script control is really heavy duty.
Well, it's the ultimate. And when the DOD, for instance, you know, gets in bed with producers or film companies on major motion pictures, it usually demands some kind of script control because they don't want you saying nasty things about the Defense Department.
That's right. Or...
So this is de rigueur. This is par for the course. Nothing of this yet would be unusual except for De Palma's wigging out at the last minute, which really doesn't make any sense because if you've got your reputation on the line and, you know, doing a campaign for a film was a little bit like doing a campaign for president.
$120 million is on the line.
Exactly. But for De Palma, it's not his money. It was the studio's money, but it's his reputation.
Well, so I know, but the studio would have every reason to have this guy in front of every camera and microphone they could find over the next few days.
One would think there'd be an incentive from De Palma himself to talk over the heads of a few press that didn't get the film.
Of course.
And talk directly to the American people, to the film community, to CNN, to you, to whoever. Instead, De Palma has done a disappearing white rabbit trick. He's down some hidey hole somewhere, not talking to anybody. Now, you and I have been doing the kind of, you know, previews of this for what, 2 or 3 weeks now?
I'm sure we're putting dollars in the box office already, I'm sure.
Well, I emphatically want to urge people to, on Friday and across the weekend, go see this film, because it turns out that this is like a magical mystery tour of the monuments of Mars. And what we're going to probably think of between you and me is some kind of prize for the person who calls in, you know, in the next few days, having seen the film, and spots all of the hyperdimensional Sidonia Monuments of Mars Enterprise Hoegland Clinky Dinkies.
All right, and
there's
going to be a ton of that. I mean, that will be a contest. But here comes the clincher, folks. This is the clincher. Now, I've seen the trailer that's running for Mission to Mars. And in the trailer that I have seen, they show a face. And the face could be more. Said to be more closely resembling an alien gray than the face that is, we all know, at Sidonia.
Yeah, this was first revealed during the Super Bowl, during halftime. And it looks like a kind of a stylized alien gray.
Yeah.
And we have it up on our website. You can link to it through Art Bell's site.
Right.
And, you know, again, if you want to hold the theory, the opinion, that this is a neat piece of science fiction, and De Palma pulled out of thin air the idea of a face on Mars and made his own, you know, you could make it stick in terms of the face that they have created that's in the so-called trailers. But there's another side to the story.
Yeah, here it comes. Now listen very carefully, everybody. We have talked to a person no less than the editor of the National Post in Toronto, the entertainment editor for the National Post in Toronto, Canada, whose name is Richard.
Well, I thought we were going to give him away.
I thought you meant that was your other source you were talking about.
No, I... Well, okay.
In other words, you said we're not...
playing conspiracy here.
Well, no...
Well, all right. His name is... you know, we don't want to beat around the bush. His name is David Giammarco.
Right.
He's been in the business for 14, 15 years.
And he is, in fact, the editor of the National Post in Toronto,
I think he's the senior entertainment writer for the Post.
Great, fine, it's fine. Okay, fine.
But he's the guy who's flown around, you know, and they do a slew of movies, and they review them all. And
he's seen the movie, right?
He has seen the movie, and he's going to see it again tomorrow night.
All right.
They're showing it in Toronto, and they've invited him again to see it, because they've flown Prince now to various cities. Touchstone has put on a major full-court press.
All right, but here's where it gets really, really, really weird, folks. Giammarco, is that right?
Giammarco
has sent a verbatim transcript of the new Mission to Mars trailer, one that apparently alternates with the one that's running. I haven't seen it yet, but he sent us a verbatim transcript of it.
Which has been seen by several people who have contacted me on Sci-Fi, on the Learning Channel, and a couple other places.
All right, let me read this to the audience so it'll blow their mind. It's an email to Richard. It says, Richard, here's the verbatim transcript of the new M2M trailer. In authoritative voiceover, for 25 years, the government has concealed evidence of a lifelike formation on Mars. Then a wide shot of Mars and a close-up of Sidonia. Then extreme close-up of face. And it goes on March 10th, the conspiracy will be exposed. Dialogue from film. It's the face. It's real. Somebody put that thing there, and it's not us. Then the voiceover continues, but some secrets should never be uncovered. A faithful rendering of that email?
Precise. Now, the key thing is here, the images that accompany this are not the made-up face that De Palma has in the film.
But, in fact, the face of on Mars, Cydonia, the one you wrote
Viking,
about.
From the Viking NASA imagery.
It's impossible, Richard. Now, the only... Now, what can we imagine might have happened here? Did he confirm that the trailer face matched the movie face?
That we have not yet done. However, tonight we have some new news. One of our correspondents has found an article, and I'm trying to get a hard copy, where De Palma was interviewed many months ago.
Yes.
And apparently talked about the creation of two endings for Mission to Mars. That's new news, Art. You didn't even know that, okay?
Two endings, huh?
Two endings. And the other thing that we can confirm on the record from Gianmarco this afternoon, because he has been pursuing the Disney folks to try to get to the bottom of this, going up the ladder, you know, higher and higher executives, to try to find out why De Palma won't talk to anybody, particularly people who are sympathetic, that are not going to pan the film, but want to talk about all the neat points in the film. He confirmed this afternoon, according to the public relations people who put the budgets together for these promos, these trailers, that the Attack NASA campaign, you know, like Attack McCain or Attack Gore or whatever, the Attack NASA campaign, accusing the government of a cover-up for 20 years to be solved by this movie, is only about 2 weeks old. Now, what favorite radio program for the last couple of weeks has been featuring the rest of the story?
Right here, folks. And Mission Mars people had just been begging me to have somebody on up until 2 weeks ago when we began to tell you I don't know whether it's the rest of the story, the other side of the story, or just a bunch of hype to get a bunch of people to go to the movie, which certainly will succeed in my case. I'll be right there.
Likewise.
We've got, apparently, our source, who we've named, has a videotape of this trailer.
Yes, he was able to tape it.
All right, I have
and
a request.
He's sending copies to you and to me.
Yeah, but they won't arrive in time. So
probably not.
I have a request of my audience coming up in a moment. Stay right there, Richard. It's the bottom of the hour. We'll be right back, and get ready for my request.
A very old friend came by today.
One thing's for certain, anything can happen on Coast to Coast AM. No ands, ifs, or buts about it.
I'm with a society, it's not the Masons, it's an offshoot called the Mystical Order of the Dequad Gerbil, and
you lion sucker, the Mystical Order of the Dequad Gerbil, my eye. I don't believe it for a second.
Oh, really?
Dequad Gerbil. Dequad Gerbil, there's no such thing.
Oh, yeah, it's a rigorous process to get in.
Yeah, I'm sure it is, and I'm sure a lot of your members end up in the hospital, too. Goodbye, you're out of here. Mr. Order of the Declawed Gerbil, my butt. That I shouldn't have said.
Yeah. ride? Call Art Bell from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at area code 775-727-1222 or call the wildcard line at 775-727-1295. To talk with Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
Well, good morning, everybody. Richard C. Hoegland is here. We're talking about Mission to Mars now. Once again, I need your help, and here's how I need it. If any of you have this new Mission to Mars trailer on tape, videotape, or you can tape it, turn it into an MPEG-3 file and send it to me in email. You'll never know how much I would appreciate that. I'm Art Bell at mindspring.com, and I need a copy of this quickly. Consider what's on this trailer in authoritative voiceover. Now, ask yourself as I read this, would NASA approve this? For 25 years, the government has concealed evidence of a lifelike formation on Mars. Script approval? then a wide shot of Mars. And then a close-up of the real face on Cydonia. Now, you think about it. You think they would have approved that one. You know the way NASA has been about the face on Mars, right? So there are two trailers out there, and I need a copy of this trailer from somebody in the audience. As soon as possible. In a moment, we'll discuss, if true, what this might mean. Be good music for Mission to Mars. Oh, love that, actually. All right, now, we're going to discuss what all of this may mean in a moment, right now, actually. All right, now, let's think about this. If this trailer is as stated, what might this mean? To me, it might mean the following. Touchstone / Disney is screwing with us all for promotional purposes, and myself and Richard in particular. Could mean that. It could mean Mr. De Palma is screwing with NASA, which of course would mean that he would have burned his bridges forever with NASA, something you wouldn't think he would do. And that's all I can think it would mean. I mean, either there's some giant promotional brouhaha doing with this second trailer, and it's really aimed at stirring up controversy, which it sure is doing, and ticking off Richard and myself. Or De Palma has ticked off NASA, and I've not heard any comment from NASA yet, but you just know if it's a real face at Cydonia, either in the trailer or the movie, they're going to be really, really pissed. What have I missed here, Richard?
Even more so, because remember, the line in the film says it sets up the conspiracy for 25 years. The government
absolutely
has kept you in the dark. And then it says, on March 10th, the conspiracy will be exposed. This is stabbing the agency in the back.
Big time. Now, maybe that's why De Palma, De Palma's now not doing interviews.
Well, but this campaign to do this, these trailers did not appear until about 3 or 4 days after he had disappeared.
Or,
in other words, they had not run.
Or could it mean that De Palma wanted to use the real Cydonia as an ending and got overruled?
Well, we don't know what his contract reads, and that's one of the things that David is going to try to find out between now and Thursday when we're going to do our final last-minute update before the film premieres. Think bigger, though. I don't know whether you're an aficionado of John Huston or John Ford films with John Wayne, but back during World War II and during the Korean War and even up through the Vietnam War, film companies, major studios, would go to the Defense Department, would go to the government, and basically get millions, if not tens of millions of dollars of stuff contributed for free.
Big time. In Vietnam. Remember the final Wayne picture?
The Green Beret picture.
Yeah, of course. Well, that was nothing but almost propaganda, really.
Well, and they used to shoot on bases. They used to shoot, I remember Jimmy Stewart on the B-52, the Strategic Air Command. I mean, all of these films You have a major studio like Disney.
Huey's at your disposal, I mean, whatever.
And aircraft carriers. Remember Silent Running, where they borrowed a whole aircraft carrier as a spaceship?
You bet.
This is, it goes back decade after decade after decade. You know, the U.S. government has been in bed with the Hollywood film community in contributing a major portion of their budget for set and personnel and all kinds of other little perks. What Disney has done is to basically cut themselves off from all of that.
Well, maybe.
Not just in NASA,
but Richard, you've got to imagine this also might be a De Palma thing. In other words, he may have...
No, there were two endings. This afternoon, again, David got confirmation from Disney this is an official Touchstone campaign. And the person who talked to David says, I just wish we'd done it a lot earlier. Because she, and it was a she, realized the enormous PR value of getting the entire Art Bell audience that's been following our work for the last, you know what, 5 years, 8 years, 10 years, whatever it is, to go and see this film to find out what the hell they buried
in
the
film. Yeah, but Richard, that might be the reason for the second trailer. That might be the only reason for the second trailer.
Yeah, but you can't legally have an agency on board and then turn around and stab them in the back. There are relationships. There are actual contractual relationships.
Oh, I understand.
The other thing you
don't
do...
But what if it's just in the trailer, not in the film?
Yeah, but even the trailer. I mean, you've got, simultaneous with this trailer, you've got people like Story Musgrave, astronaut of 30 years, who was at the press premieres, made available, talked to various members of the press.
I heard he was on the set.
He was on, well, of course he was on the set because he was a key consultant to the manned spaceflight aspects, you know, missions to Mars, space stations, rendezvous, docking, EVAs, the whole nine yards. Musgrave was a key player in setting up this film from technical, accurate points of perspective. Gianmarco interviewed him and is going to discuss this in some detail on Thursday night.
On Thursday. Interviewed Story about this?
About the film and asked him point blank questions. And Musgrave insists that NASA is the most wide-open government agency that has ever existed. There's no cover-up of anything. There are no UFOs. There's no evidence. They're all nuts, etc.
Nuts? But how does that... How does
square
that,
with this...
For 25 proposal? Years, the government has concealed evidence of lifelike formation on
Precisely.
Mars.
Precisely. So what you're doing is not only making the agency look bad, but you're taking one of your own key consultants and making him look like a fool. Because you're saying officially from Disney, this man's a damn liar.
But why are we saying... De Palma, why is he not giving interviews? There are two possibilities. One is that he's not getting his way, and he's angry. And that he's not getting the ending that he wants in the movie.
That's true.
Right? Isn't that possible?
That's possible. Or...
Or...
And this is the one that I really love. He is off somewhere secretly editing his new ending and that's being shipped even as we speak to all the theaters. And this has been done before. Remember, Art, I mentioned 2001?
Yes.
When Kubrick went, he had a screening in New York and the critics really didn't like it. They didn't get it. They didn't understand it. So he, on a train between New York and Los Angeles for the L.A. premiere, he re-edited the film.
On the train?
On the train.
2001.
2001, the classic film that, by the way, said that if they find it, they will hide it.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're coming up to the year. And then
sure.
A different film premiered, courtesy of this genius, Stanley Kubrick, in Los Angeles, than the few critics who'd seen it in New York saw. So it has been done before. Now we've got this interview with De Palma in print, which I'm going to hopefully get hold of tomorrow, which was done months ago, where he talked about filming two endings. Kind of a little bit like Lady and the Tiger, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So, I am praying that Brian De Palma, because of the relationship with Bruce De Palma...
May I ask a question?
...who was our colleague...
Yes.
...has seen the light and understands that history is bigger than NASA and that there's going to be one heck of an interesting ending for this film where Gary Sinise says some very remarkable things.
Well,
just have to all...
I'll tell you something, Richard. If they tried, they couldn't do a better job of driving my audience to the theater and driving me to the theater. You got me. What I first need, folks, is a copy of this trailer. Somebody MPEG-3 this sucker to me as fast as you can, please, in its entirety. Now, this is not the trailer with the gray-looking alien face. This is this one will actually show the face on Mars, the one that Richard...
Well, according to Giammarco, who's seen it, and according to Mike Barra, who has his wife saw it...
This trailer will have 25 years of government cover-up.
You got it. And it has the colorized versions of Sidonia very close to what we have from Carlotto on our website as part of our review of Mission to Mars. I mean, this is pretty interesting, say the least.
Well, I can imagine, Richard, the people in the studio sitting there saying, look, let's get another trailer out there. Let's make this one a little different. And it's going to just drive them out of their minds. And as part of it, we'll have De Palma not say anything for a while. And the controversy will go nuts on the Art Bell Show. Because that's exactly what's happening. So what better way to get people into the theater?
Given that we already know some of the interesting things that are touched on in the film, the story notwithstanding, the characters and their interaction and all that, we know they deal with the Martians as the progenitors of humankind.
Yeah, that's no secret. They hold up the DNA strands and everything,
We were there, 20 years ago, folks. That's what the Monuments of Mars, A City on the Edge of Forever, the book I wrote covering this entire investigation for the last almost 20 to 25 years, details with the evidence to support it. So, the only thing they can do to really put it over the top, the only thing De Palma could do, a la his brother, remember, Bruce De Palma, his brother, the physicist, who worked so closely with us,
yes,
who I debuted at the United Nations in terms of his stunning physics experiments, which confirmed in the lab the hyperdimensional physics model we developed, a la Sidonia. There's another report which... should I wait till Thursday to let David tell you directly, or should I give it away tonight? We have some very important news regarding, first-person news regarding Bruce De Palma and Brian De Palma that David Giammarco will tell you from a first-person testimony on Thursday night. So there is a critical piece of evidence that there was a very close relationship in Bruce's final days on this planet before he died between these two brothers. And that can only mean, in a logical way of thinking, that Brian De Palma is looking to history and not to NASA, and maybe has risen to the occasion in a way that will make us all very proud come Friday night.
This just is all impossible, and I just really can't put my finger on...
Well, what's really impossible is, you obviously forgotten, but when I think back where I was precisely 1 year ago tonight, in an emergency room, with tubes stuck in me.
I remember, yeah.
Wondering if I was going to be around to see anything like this.
Heart attack, yeah.
This is kind of interesting. Life is totally unpredictable. Totally.
Well, I wonder, Richard, if you'd kicked the bucket then, whether at the end of this movie it would have said, for Richard. Sorry.
I think I'd rather stick around and write the ending myself.
Yeah, I hear you. Or interpret the ending or whatever. But, of course, you did write the book all those years ago, The Monuments of Mars, which, by the way, people can still get. If you want to see the original research, it's in Monuments of Mars. And how do they get that, Richard?
Well, you can do several things. You can log on to Enterprise Mission, and you just follow the links, and it will take you to ship stores, and you can get the book there.
Uh-huh.
It's also distributed all over the country in major bookstores. It's on Amazon.com. Just log on to Amazon.com and, type in Monuments of Mars in the search, and you'll find it. And it's apparently bumped up to some very high numbers. Amazon has something like 250,000 titles.
Oh, they do.
In titles.
Right.
And we're somewhere on the first 10,000 now. So, somebody's been buying a lot of Monuments of Mars, and in particular, the numbers appear to have climbed in the last few weeks as this film has made its way through the grapevine and through the radio and on the internet and all that. And I can imagine that people, after they see the film, would not want to see the real story, read the real research, all the players, all the scientists.
Wait a minute, Richard, I got another one. What if, try this out for size, Richard, what if De Palma made the change and NASA okayed it? Slim chance, I admit, but
well,
I imagine...
Well, no, you're on to something. Because remember, we've said for a long time that there are two contingents in NASA.
In other words, the contingent that you talk of as the other or the dark side winked and said, do it.
Well, no, it's the bright side. It's the ones that know and have been too afraid to speak up.
Well, I know, but the dark side would have to be winking.
No,
at least winking.
They would have to be snookered. In other words, what De Palma would then have done would be to do two endings. One that these guys approved.
Yeah, and one they
appeared to be safe. And then one which blows the doors off. Remember, it says, on March 10th, the conspiracy will be exposed. Well,
yeah.
The only way it can be exposed is if somewhere in the film you say, hey, folks, there's been a conspiracy for the last 30 years. Keep this under wraps.
Yep. And, of course, the bigger picture is that what this story is telling us is that we are from Mars. We are descendants of, or creations of, because I haven't seen the movie yet, I don't know, whatever, Martians.
Yep.
That the DNA that is everything we are came from over there.
Which I think I said pretty much on Fox about a year ago during the Lost Tomb special. In other words, that's where our research has been leading us, in the inexorable direction that somehow we and the, quote, Martians are inextricably connected some way. What this film has done with $120 million is to basically put it on the widescreen with a hell of a lot of special effects, a sterling cast,
yeah,
and a director who has disappeared.
I don't know. The whole thing is really intriguing, which is probably exactly what they intend for it to be.
Well, you know, if ever the comment was appropriate, it's certainly now. Stay tuned.
Stay tuned. Right. Richard, one last quick question, and it's got to be quick. We got those rotten, stinking pictures of the face on Mars that in no way resembled the pictures, the original Viking photos. Since then, we've had a zillion really good pictures of Mars taken.
Oh, stunning.
Stunning, stunningly good in great detail. How come we can't get Cydonia again with a good photo this time? Why not?
Well, I have a feeling that if enough people go to see this film,
yeah,
and then, you know, tune into us as we discuss the contents and the various layerings of the real research embedded by De Palma in this,
yes,
including all those 19.5s I've been telling you about,
yeah,
that we can then muster another campaign to demand of Dan Golden and this administration, based on the enormous success of the film, that we go back and get some more decent pictures of Cydonia to
go back
show us
and
what's
take
really
the,
there.
Some more damn pictures, for heaven's sakes.
Absolutely. Because if you compare the quality of what was taken a year ago in 98, in April, and the quality of what he's been taking, Malin is taking all over now.
What we could do now, right?
Yep.
There's no comparison.
Somehow that camera works amazingly well, except when it's pointed at Cydonia.
All right. Thursday, the next installment of this, somebody send me an MPEG before I go nuts over this. Thank you, Richard.
And I have one last thing to say.
It better be awful quick.
Aunt Doris, go to bed. It's too late for you.
Later. Aunt Doris, go to bed. I'm Art Bell. All of you out there, don't you go to bed.
A beauty queen, she made a ride to cause the scene in the town. Her long blonde hair hanging down around her knees. All the cats who did striptease, praying for a little breeze. Her long blonde hair falling down across her.
To reach Kingdom of Nye. From west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222 or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network.
That's exactly what it is. Good morning, everybody. Evening for some of you, whatever time zone you're in. We're about to talk about urban legends. Do you know what an urban legend is? Well, we'll have that. I guess we'll define that right off the bat, and there are a gazillion of them out there. I've almost been taken in. Well, I have been taken in by a couple, actually. And I'll tell you about them. My guest, though, is an expert in this area. I'll tell you more about him in a moment. This is not an urban legend, but I wanted to mention it because I've been seeing it on television, and I think it's a riot. I have no idea what the movie is coming out shortly. It's a trailer for a movie coming out shortly. And these two guys are in a car. They're going down the highway, and on the right-hand side, here is this really shapely, good-looking chick. And she's got a miniskirt on. And, you know, they look at each other, and they look at the girl. And she's trying to hitch a ride, right? And the driver says, oh, man, you know, this is how a lot of horror movies start. Just like this. And the other guy says, yeah, I know. That's also the way a lot of porn movies start, too. Pick her up. Not an urban legend. What is an urban legend? We're about to find out. For more than a decade, Richard Roeper has been tracking urban legends on a daily basis in his Chicago Sun-Times column. That's right, the Chicago Sun-Times. He writes for the Chicago Sun-Times, which is also syndicated by the New York Times syndicate to newspapers just everywhere. Roeper has appeared on NBC Nightly News with Tom Brokaw, CBS Evening News with Dan Rather, has appeared on Nightline, Oprah, appears twice weekly as a commentator on Fox News, has been a Chicago radio personality throughout the 90s. Well, he's done it all. As a journalist, Richard has been honored with many awards, including the National Headliner Award as the outstanding newspaper columnist in the country. No small matter indeed. So in a moment, urban legends. Right now, it is the deal of the century. The new Super Bajan radio is out. All right, here we go. Richard Roeper, welcome to the program.
Art, it's a thrill to be here. And, you know, you mentioned that you have maybe been the subject of some urban... You actually are an urban legend.
I've been the victim of any number, no question about it. Thank you, an urban legend. Now, that would imply, though, that an urban legend has a kernel of truth buried within it somewhere.
I think that's a really good point, launching point here. I mean, the reason these things exist and thrive is because there is a kernel of truth in a lot of them, and they're just believable enough, or they may even have occurred once or twice, but it just gets to the point where you hear them so often that they become embellished and they become these urban legends.
Well, on your book it says the truth behind all those deliciously entertaining myths that are absolutely, positively, 100% not true.
Yeah, and that goes to show you, Art, that you sometimes have copywriters who get involved in the titles of books. Because I wouldn't say, well, I'd say maybe a few of these might be 100% not true, but I'd say most of them definitely have a strong foundation in the world of reality.
Well, let me tell you about the one that just about got me. It didn't quite, but it got it was so close. A guy goes to a party in Vegas. Now, it's written up in various cities in various ways. This legend has grown. And, you know, you get slipped a Mickey from some beautiful girl.
Sure.
He goes to the hotel with her. He passes out. He wakes up in a bathtub full of ice cubes, usually.
Mm-hmm.
There's a note next to him saying, quick, call 911. And he's had a kidney removed. In other words, it was a kidney sting. And when I first read that, I went, oh my
God, right over the hill in Las Vegas, they're taking kidneys down.
And that one has gone around the internet like a virus.
That's probably the single most prevalent urban legend that's out there. And that's classic example, Art, of a story that definitely has some foundations in truth. Because, you know...
Oh, you're kidding.
Well, there absolutely are some cases of gentlemen, if you will, on business conventions or vacations or whatever, who have been slipped Mickeys by women who have robbed them. Yeah, I mean,
well,
okay,
robbed them. Fine,
you
sure.
Know.
Oh, sure, sure.
But this, you know, this whole horror story element about the kidney theft. Now, what I love about that story is that this gal or gals who are out there doing this this harvesting of vital organs, that they're nice enough to submerge the guy in a tub of ice and put him near a phone and then give him a note saying, call 911. You'd think if they're going to be as heartless to heartless enough to take the kidney that they'd go ahead and let the guy die. So I love that part of the story. I also like the idea that some woman who's wearing a short skirt and high heels and picks up a guy in a bar has the skills, the surgical skills, to actually remove the organ and take it, and that she has the connections that she knows where to sell it on the black market.
Oh,
so,
well, now, wait a minute. You got to imagine there's a skilled team of, you know, very dark surgeons waiting that will rush in once the Mickey takes its effect and do their job and take the kidney away in one of those little things with ice in it.
In the adjacent room.
In the adjacent room, that's right. She calls him once he's out.
And then in the next room, there's the potential recipient of the organ who just happens to be a match for this kidney and who's ready for the surgery. So as is the case in a lot of these urban legends, are when you really start dissecting them, if you will, you'll see that they really don't pan out. But again, yeah, I mean, is it true that men have been slipped Mickeys and have been knocked out by gales? Absolutely.
Yeah, but Richard, I almost read this one on the air. I went,
Did you really? Oh my God.
I mean, there are so many horror stories in real life. That's why these things work, because I think the American people are numb to what can go on, you know, kids killing kids, six-year-olds, all that kind of stuff. So it's one of those things where you go, oh, geez, you know, right over the hill from me. Usually it's Vegas. And so I came that close to reading that on the air.
And you
news.
Know what? Had you read that on the air, you would not have been the first broadcaster to fall for something. I mean, a lot of these stories have been reported as truth either by, you know, radio hosts or newspaper columnists or TV anchors, whatever the case may be. And part of the reason is because they really do have that element of credibility, and it's also just much more fun to believe these things are really happening.
Uh-huh.
And you make a really good point. There's so much stuff that goes on every day in the real world that is beyond anything you or I could ever create, that when we hear these unbelievable tales, you think, well, why not?
How are we to delineate? Because truth really is stranger than a lot of fiction.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the only thing you can do is always try to get the person who it occurred to or the firsthand witness, you know, the eyewitness. And so often, and you know how it goes, and I know your listeners know how it goes, people tell you a story and they claim that it happened to a friend. And then when you ask them, well, what is the name of the friend? And then they say, well, it wasn't really my friend. It was my friend's cousin,
that's
hairdresser's
right.
best friend's next-door neighbor. And you say, will you get that next-door neighbor to call me? And they say, I will. I'll get that person to call you. And then, of course, the story falls apart because you can never actually find the source.
So, in other words, you get a lot as a columnist for the Chicago Sun-Times and, I guess, nationally syndicated. You get a lot of that, huh?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And a lot of times I'll hear from readers who know I write about this stuff, and they'll say, hey, this has got to be an urban legend. But just as often, I hear from people saying, you've got to write about this. You've got to expose this ring of kidney thieves. And I always write back and say, give me the facts, and I guarantee you, if we have the story that there really is something like this going on, I promise you I'll write about it. But the story always falls apart.
All right, so that's the big one. But it's only the tip of the legend iceberg, right?
Absolutely.
What are some of the other good ones out there?
Well, I'll tell you, I'll give you one that's so new that I don't even have it in the book, but it's been making the rounds the last month or so, and it's the one. And again, you mentioned the internet, and that is the number one distributor of urban legends.
It's the breeding. It's the breeding ground.
It really is, because it used to take, you know, years for these things to develop, because you'd have to tell a friend. Now all you have to do is hit that, you know, that button, that forward button on your computer, and it goes to 50 of your closest friends.
That's it.
And here's one I get almost every day. And most of the time when I get this one from people, they think it's true, and they want me to write the expose on this. And it's about the supposed study conducted at the University of New Hampshire on Kentucky Fried Chicken, the chicken itself, in which they determined that it's not made from an actual chicken, but it's made from a synthetic grade of chicken, and that's why Kentucky Fried Chicken has changed its name to KFC. I love that one. So they're calling it KFC now because the truth is it's not really chicken, and government regulations prohibit them from calling it something it's not. And please be aware of this. And the poor folks at the University of New Hampshire have actually had a, issue statement saying, guess what, we've never done such a study. And, of course, Kentucky Fried Chicken has been reduced to having to tell people, look, we changed our name 9 years ago to KFC because fried just doesn't have a good connotation anymore. We didn't want people saying fried, and also because they offer so many other foods.
Well, this is supposed to be what, according to legend? Some sort of a genetically engineered, really weird chicken?
Exactly, that they've been able to do that so that, to cut down on costs, but of course it's no good for you. And people are always citing this New Hampshire study, and they'll even, the emails will include these very realistic-looking press releases or excerpts from the study. I'm telling you, every day, Art, I hear from somebody who tells me about the Kentucky KFC study.
Well, if some newspaper falls for it somewhere and they do a story on it, then that feeds the legend itself.
Absolutely.
And then by the time you get it, you've got these clippings, and you're going, I imagine the first time you got it, you went, wow. Or did you go, BS?
Well, my antenna are pretty, they're pretty finely tuned at this point. So this, I just thought, this has got all the makings of an urban legend because, again, little kernel of truth, if you want to say kernel reference to KFC, because Kentucky Fried Chicken did change its name to KFC. So there's that little bit of truth. Beyond that, it's all bogus. So, I look at something like that, I go, is it true? Probably not. But a lot of times in the urban legend, they'll say, well, it was reported on CNN, or it was reported on this and that radio show. And it's the kind of thing where you might not, if you weren't listening or watching at the time, it's kind of hard to prove that it was never reported on a particular network.
What got you interested in urban legends anyway? Was it just the fact that you had to deal with so many reports, or what got you going?
Yeah, and also I just think it's a real fascinating study in human nature. And when I first started writing about these, I was like you. I came real close to reporting one as fact. And when I first started writing about these in the 80s, and that was the story about, it's kind of similar to the kidney theft one. It's another one where somebody wakes up. And in this case, it's a guy who has a one-night stand, and he wakes up the next morning, and written in lipstick on the mirror in his bathroom is the message, "Welcome to the world of AIDS."
Oh my God.
In other words, he had been seduced by a woman who had carried the deadly virus and was exacting her revenge on the men of the world by spreading it as often as possible.
Yeah, but you know what? There were early on in the 80s some people who allegedly, in fact, did spread the AIDS virus intentionally. I can think of a dentist that was alleged to have done that.
Yep, dentist down in Florida.
Yep.
Who died, I think, as I recall, before all the trials were, were played out. And it appeared as if that had actually been the case. There was a case right here in Chicago of a man who, had a hypodermic needle with his own AIDS-infected blood, and he was trying to inject people. So, it's true that there have existed these monsters who unfortunately were infected with the disease and then tried to exact the revenge on the world.
But this particular story, Welcome to the World of AIDS in lipstick on the mirror.
No evidence that it ever happened. In fact, I was told that it happened at the University of Tennessee, and then I heard later on that it happened, at the University of Illinois. No, it happened in Vermont. And, you start hearing different locales, and you think, okay, wait a minute. It could have happened once. It could not have happened 24 times.
All right, so there must be a group of people out there. In other words, I could understand how the first one gets started,
mm-hmm.
but it's not repeated faithfully. So that must mean that somebody, for example, gets an email
mm-hmm.
and then changes the story to suit their own needs
yep.
and reissues the story. This has got to be intentional disinformation.
I think in some cases it definitely is, and I think in the cases of some of the stories we've been talking about, people have a certain agenda. There's almost a moral behind these stories. In other words, if you're a businessman and you're at a convention in Las Vegas, if you don't go out and pick up some woman, you won't have this terrible thing happen to you where your kidney gets stolen. And if you're a college student and you don't participate in indiscriminate sex with strangers, you won't wake up and get this message. So they're cautionary tales just as the urban legends in the 50s about, you know, the killer with the hook on his hand or the babysitter being terrorized by a prank caller, you know, they're always sort of moral tales saying, well, if you don't participate in these activities, these bad things won't happen.
Well, then might we not suspect even groups of, let's just go really out on a ledge and say, how about the religious right? Could they be the source of some of this stuff?
It could be the religious right. It could be certain liberal factions. It could be absolutely people with special interests of whatever sort. It could be, in some cases, unfortunately, it can be racism at work or, you know, any kind of group that has a certain agenda or a certain message that they want to get out there. Huh. And they're warning you about this dangerous world and certain activities in this immoral world that we live in. So I think it's absolutely right. I mean, it's also true that a lot of times people are just innocently passing these along because they believe them to be true and they think they're helping their friends by issuing warnings. But let's not be naive. In a lot of cases, it's people spreading these stories on purpose.
Are you on the internet a lot?
Absolutely, every day.
Okay. Well, I don't think this necessarily qualifies as an urban legend, but if you're on the internet every day, your mailbox has got to be full of these giant warnings in capital letters, exclamation points. Mm-hmm. Don't open so-and-so. It's a virus. Your entire computer system will be destroyed.
Yeah.
Right? And how many of those are true?
Yeah, those have been almost always untrue. But again, we have heard stories, I mean, just in the last couple of months about hackers who have created trouble with major internet companies and have, you know, spread viruses where people have had their whole systems crash and that sort of thing. But most of the time in those cases are, once again, it's my belief that the people spreading those stories are disgruntled ex-employees of companies or rivals of companies.
Yeah.
So you'll see someone sending, you know, there's a lot of warnings about AOL, America Online, that one of the giants of the industry. And they're saying, don't get AOL 5.0 because if you install it, your computer's going to crash. Or don't open this. Or if you see, and you know, again, I think you know they're trying to damage a company's reputation there.
Or they'll have little things like don't open Party Hardy or don't open Happy Days or actually Happy Days was one. I'm not sure, but how I know is Happy 99 EXE, which is a stupid little virus. So there are stupid little viruses out there, but 99% of the warnings are all complete and total BS. Richard, we're at the bottom of this hour, so hold on. We'll be right back. There's a million of them out there. Richard Roeper is my guest, and we're discussing urban legends. Every now and then, there is a little bit of truth behind some of these. So it's not 100% untrue, and they're interesting to listen to. Imagine waking up in the ice. Call 911.
Sweet dreams are made of these. Who am I to disagree? I travel the world and the seven seas. Everybody's looking for something. Some of them want to use you. Some of them want to get used by you. The music.
Well, call Art Bell from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. The wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. And to reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network.
Or if you're in a bathtub full of ice right now and you have a note, for God's sakes, call 911, not me. Urban legends is what we're talking about. The Chicago Sun-Times Richard Roeper is my guest. And there are so many urban legends. We're going to get to more of them. I wonder how many you have heard. I want you all to be careful because some of what we are going to discuss is, by its very nature, adult-oriented. And so, you know, if you have children in the room, whisk them away. They ought not be up at this hour anyway. Shouldn't be here anyway. So get them out of the room because some of it is definitely adult-oriented. Richard, welcome back.
Thanks, Art.
All right. What's this thing about a dog swallowing a cell phone? That's one I'd never heard.
Oh, I love that one, and that's obviously one of the newer urban legends. The story, as it's been told, especially in some of the tabloid publications, is about the guy who gives his loved one, his girlfriend, if you will, one of those tiny little cell phones as a Christmas gift.
Right.
And, you know, she's just thrilled about this new gift, and they continue on with the opening of the presents, and there's wrapping paper and packages all over the living room floor at the end of the morning. And, you know, she says, geez, I can't find the cell phone that you gave me. I don't know where it's at. It's somewhere in this pile. So they're digging around, and they can't find the cell phone anywhere. So finally the boyfriend gets the bright idea. He says, you know what? He goes, I'll call your number on my cell phone. And the phone will ring, and we'll be able to figure out where it's at.
Right.
So he dials up the number, and there's a ringing going on somewhere under the tree. And she goes, boy, it seems to be ringing right near Sparky, good old beloved Sparky, or
Sparky.
Her little dog. And she finally realizes when she puts her ear on Sparky's tummy that it's actually the dog is ringing. The phone itself has been swallowed by the dog. And, of course, she's mad at him, you know, their boyfriend, and, oh, my, how could this have happened? They call the veterinarian, and he says, you know, there's nothing we could do about this other than to simply let nature take its course. So, you know, sometime later that day, Sparky goes out to the backyard and does his duty, and
there it is.
This modern device of technology. And my favorite part about this story is, Art, there was I know at least one of the tabloids actually ran a picture of a woman holding the cell phone and the dog, and she's smiling.
Oh, no, you're kidding.
And I'm thinking, you know, gosh, even if this could have happened, would you be holding the cell phone up next to your face after?
Well, anyway, it couldn't happen. Everybody knows something that size goes down to your stomach. It is not going to be transferred anywhere. It's not going to be pooped out.
Yeah, even the largest dog and the smallest phone, if you start talking about intestinal tracts and things like this, you realize that the dog might be able to chew on a phone. He may swallow parts of his phone, but, you know, he's not going to swallow the whole thing. And even if he did, it ain't coming out in working condition. Yet I hear from people all the time who swear they've heard this story.
Or more likely, the dog's not going to come out in working condition.
Exactly.
You can almost mentally picture it tumbling through the... Well, it's too awful to even talk about.
It really is, isn't it?
Yeah. So that one's zeroed out.
I've been told by many people that they swear that they know somebody it happened to, and I just have a standing offer. I said, you know what, you bring all the principals in this story, you know, in to meet me, and I'll write the story up. And then, of course, the person who this supposedly happened to just vaporizes.
Well, what are we to imagine, though? I mean, here's a picture of a girl with a smiling cell phone and the dog. To substantiate, where the hell did that come from?
Well, we're to imagine that maybe the tabloid paid a model a couple hundred dollars to pose with Sparky and a cell phone because it's a fun story, you know.
I see. All right. Well, let's see. You've got so many here that I want to know about. The prehistoric Barbie doll?
Yeah, that's kind of a fun one. That's the story about the burnt-out hippie who keeps digging up things in his backyard and thinking he's found artifacts from a previous time, and he sends them into the Smithsonian, and they finally write him a letter back in very technical terms explaining to him that what he thinks is this prehistoric fossil is actually a Barbie doll, and they use all these terms that make it seem like, it's, you know, they're basically trying to tell him, hey, you know, you're nuts and you're wasting our time. And the supposed letter from the Smithsonian has been circulating for years because it's supposed to be an example of how they're wasting our time with government money and resources by responding to these nutcases. But you call the Smithsonian and they say, look, you know, we've never had anybody who's received a Barbie doll, and if we did, we wouldn't waste our time sending him a letter back explaining to him that he sent us a Barbie doll.
All right. This is one that I get. I think I get it every day, actually, and this is kind of adult-oriented, but it's the Good Luck Mr. Gorski story about the first man upon the moon. And
Neil Armstrong.
Neil Armstrong, yes.
And that's for some reason, that one's really been making the rounds again lately. And
big time.
And yeah, we'll try to go through this delicately, Art, but the story basically is that when Neil Armstrong, when man walked on the moon back in 1969, of course, there was the famous saying that's one small step for a man and one giant leap for mankind.
That's right.
That if you study the transcripts, that the next thing uttered by Neil Armstrong, it was, good luck, Mr. Gorsky. And then he goes on to talk about technical things up on the moon. And for years, people tried to dissect, what did he mean with this good luck, Mr. Gorsky deal? And there were theories that maybe that was a Russian
Before we go on, did he actually say that?
No, he didn't.
He did not say
that. He did not. And in fact, I've obtained the NASA transcripts, and you know, your enterprising listeners who know their way around the Internet can get access even there to the actual transcripts of what happened. What he said after that was, you know, a lot of technical terms just about, you know, how the surface of the moon felt and things like that, and kind of describing the feeling of being on the moon. But the supposed comment about Mr. Gorsky has just lived on in infamy, and some people thought, well, he must be signaling a Russian cosmonaut, and others said, well, it has to mean something deeper than that. And according to the urban legend, just a few years ago, there was supposedly a press conference where a young reporter asked Neil Armstrong at maybe a NASA reunion
party, right.
Or something.
That's right.
And he said, well, gosh, it's been so long, I'll finally tell the truth about this story. And the story goes that a young Neil Armstrong growing up in Ohio was playing ball in his backyard, and the ball went into the next-door neighbor's yard, and he hopped the fence, and the ball was right underneath the bedroom window of his next-door neighbor. And when he went to pick up the ball, young Neil heard his neighbor, the male, asking his wife for a certain sexual favor, and her retort to him was, you'll get that the day the kid next door walks on the moon. So that's why he said, good luck, Mr. Gorsky, because he said, okay, you're going to get lucky. Now, the reality is that there was never any such press conference where this question was asked, and that Neil Armstrong has never told the real story, because there is no real story. And when I actually, one of the fun things about this book was trying to track these down as best as I could, so I called NASA. And, of course, they'd heard the story before, and I happened to have Mr. Armstrong's home number, and he's kind of a press-shy fellow, you know, to his credit. Neil Armstrong is not a guy who's done a lot of Pop-Tart commercials and stuff over
the years. He's actually kind of a mysterious fellow in a lot of ways.
He really is.
Yeah.
He really is. And the folks at NASA strongly advised me that I probably wouldn't want to waste my time bothering this guy with the story, and I said, you know, out of all due respect to the guy, I'm going to let it go because we know it's not true. But I was very tempted to call him up and say, hey, it's Gorsky calling. Stop spreading the story about me.
I just wanted to thank you, Neil. So that one, I mean, I literally get that one every day. That one is really back up and going.
Yeah, and once again, because of the Internet. I think if not for the Internet, some of these stories might finally die out. But they just keep getting reborn. And you'd think that especially, you know, the younger people who are so cynical about, you know, don't believe everything you read or don't, you know, believe half of what you hear, you'd think people would be more jaded, but I swear they hear these stories and they still think that because it's on the Internet, it must be true.
Well, there's no way, is there? I mean, but this was, of course, these went around even before the Internet, not so well as today, but there must be some way to finally track down the author of this thing. Somebody wrote it with feeling.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they really had to think this out to get this good a story. And wouldn't it be wonderful to somehow find that person?
It really would. And you'd think that the authors, if you will, the creators of these urban legends would step forward. But, you know, trying to track the source of an urban legend is like trying to find the bottom of a bottomless pit. You know, you just keep spiraling downward and you never find ground zero. And even with, you know, some of these warnings we talked about where, you know, they're telling you about this or that virus or whatever the case may be, nobody has ever stepped forward to my knowledge and said, you know what, I'm the author of this urban legend.
Well, even if they did, who would believe them?
Who would believe them?
I mean, if you consider the Kennedy assassination,
right?
If any person were to go to a microphone and have a press conference and tell the real story of the conspiracy that killed Kennedy, it would just go on the pile of 10,000 others, and it wouldn't be believed. So if somebody came forward and admitted this, nobody would believe them.
Isn't that the truth? Somebody could step forward with a film of themselves with Lee Harvey Oswald
that's
planning
right.
it out, and people say, well, they just created that film.
That's
that can't
right.
be true. So, even if somebody stepped forward and said, you know, I'm the guy who wrote the urban legend about Neil Armstrong, and here's the documentation, we'd all say, oh, yeah, sure. So I think in a lot of these cases, either the people who came up with these realized that there's no point in stepping forward, or a lot of them were created sort of over time in a group effort. Somebody told the story as a joke, maybe, and then it got embellished, it got finely tuned a little more, and then it becomes this sort of perfectly crafted urban legend.
Mm-hmm. So in other words, if you could do it, you would likely get down to somebody who said, all I did was write up what Fred told me.
Yeah. And Fred would tell you, hey, I heard the joke in a bar one night. And the bartender would say, well, a guy walked in the other day, he swore it was true. You know, I mean, you just keep going and going. And there has to be a beginning point. But I don't even know if sometimes the person who created it knows what they've wrought.
Well, there's a beginning point, all right, though we'll never find it. What I wonder is whether there's ever any ending point. In other words, these urban legends, like the Gorski thing, mm-hmm. for example, they'll go away for a while.
Right.
And then they come back with a vengeance, and a whole new generation of people buys off on it.
Yeah, and I could never quite figure out exactly why one finally dies, and then it doesn't die, where it goes into hibernation and comes back. Although I think in some cases, you know, there are enough media reports discounting an urban legend that almost everybody knows it's not true. But then a few years go by and people kind of forget. Our classic example of this is the urban legends that start on college campuses.
Oh.
Well, yeah, after every few years, you got a whole new group of students there. So the last group that learned it wasn't true, they're gone, and the new group of students are repeating it as true.
The new suckers.
Exactly. And the teachers who have been on campus longer, the professors are saying, oh, man, we heard this 4 years ago.
Any specific examples?
Well, the classic one going around the last 10 or 15 years on many college campuses from coast to coast is the story of the psychic who goes on the Oprah Winfrey show and predicts that a psycho killer is going to strike a campus on Halloween. And campuses start getting really filled with, you know, panic because students are sending out notices and putting up, you know, flyers and bulletin boards saying, 3 days ago on the Oprah show,
yep.
A psychic came on and said a campus with an H-shaped building would have a killer on Halloween day, and we have an H-shaped building, or we have an A-shaped building, or whatever the case may be. And actually, last year, I mean, the campus of San Diego State University almost cleared out completely because people were absolutely convinced that this has happened.
Yeah, really? And all this is buoyed, of course, by Scream 1, Scream, Scream 1, Scream 2, Scream 3, Scream 10, whatever it is, slasher
exactly.
movies. And so everybody's going to be ready to believe it.
They really do. And, you know, the story, that's a pretty good little cautionary tale, the one about the supposed killer, because according to the urban legend, the killer will be dressed as Little Bo Peep, very innocent outfit, and will
really?
Be in this costume. And because it's Halloween, all kinds of people will be wearing costumes, so no one's going to even look twice at somebody dressed as Little Bo Peep. So it's sort of like, again, like the Scream movies, where there's even a disguise involved. Now, the reality is, of course, even if Oprah does some wacky shows, but she does not usually have psychics come on there and do predictions. And even if a psychic did go on and predict something as wild as that, you'd think that they'd have the sense to say, let's not run this because we're going to create a panic. So, you know, for all the wrong reasons, Oprah Winfrey has been tagged, you know, unfairly as the person who has kind of created this urban legend. She's got nothing to do with it.
I wonder why they picked Oprah, just because she has some manner of credibility. If it's on Oprah,
yep.
It's got to be true.
That's exactly right, because hers is the most popular of these sorts of shows. In fact, when this urban legend first started making the rounds, the psychic supposedly went on the Phil Donahue show, because that, at the time, 20 years ago, was the most popular talk show. So that urban legend has sort of changed to reflect the current media, you know, popularity of Oprah as opposed to Phil Donahue. But that's one that comes and goes, and, you know, it won't last 2 years in a row on the same college campus, but it will come back after 4 or 5 years.
Has anybody ever collected these before you wrote this book?
There have been some studies on urban legends. In fact, there's to give credit where it's due, there's a professor named Jan Harald Brundvand, who's actually an expert in the field of folklore and mythology, and he's been writing about this for some time. A lot of the urban legends I have in the book are newer ones. That's why I didn't talk too much about some of the urban legends from the 50s, because I felt like they've been well documented, but especially the ones that are internet-related and have either been spread on the internet or about the internet. Those are fairly new ones.
Oh, there's a lot of them about the internet. Messages saying that legislation has just been passed that you will have to pay by the minute on your telephone, which
right.
they probably considered, and various other things that all are meant to scare you to death if you're an internet user.
Yeah, absolutely. A lot of warnings out there. Unfortunately, again, a lot of companies have been tagged with unfair labels. Again, you know, to harken back to Oprah, supposedly certain clothing designers have gone on the Oprah show and have said racist remarks. And, you know, these quotes will be repeated and repeated and repeated, and people are urging boycotts of these various designers, none of whom have ever gone on her show. In fact, Oprah Winfrey took the very unusual step last year of actually going on her program and saying, I'm tired of people saying that Tommy Hilfiger has come on this show and uttered racist remarks. He's never been on the show. He's never said any such terrible things, and don't you believe it? Because it was actually, I mean, she was concerned that it was going to hurt his business.
Well, some of them, Richard, can be very damaging. There was one written about me, dispensed, we found out, from the University of California at San Diego, one of their computers. Somebody maliciously wrote a hate letter to the Filipino people.
Yes.
And let me tell you, this one's been around the world maybe two or three times now, Richard, and I'm supposedly the author of this hate message. And I'm telling you, I get these incredibly angry letters every single day from people as far away as the Philippines and Europe.
Right.
I don't, all over the world. And, of course, we've issued statements. We've put things on my website saying...
I've seen the things on your website.
My wife is half Filipino, for God's sakes. I would never write such a thing, but somebody did it, put my name to it, and they refused to not believe it.
Yeah, and that's the unfortunate fallout from this, Art, no matter what you do. And you're doing the right thing, because to ignore it is not going to make the problem go away. So you've got to put... You have done what many of these companies have done, where you just go right after the source. You try to issue the denials. You put the information on the website. You do everything you can. But you, as you know all too well, there are just going to be people who are only going to hear the urban legend and never hear the denial or never see the denial.
Of course.
And they're going to repeat it. And they think that they're performing some sort of information service. Well, here's what this guy said. Unfortunately, they're contributing to the problem. And that's why I always caution people. It's fun to talk about these things, even to share them on the internet. But you know what? At least let people know, hey, this is a fun urban legend. It's not true. In your case, it's not a fun urban legend.
Yeah, there are some fun, a lot of fun urban legends, and a lot that are not so funny that it can be damaging either to people or, as you point out, to companies.
Yeah.
And, and there have been a lot of those. There also have been a lot of urban legends that have surrounded the movies.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the best of those has got to be, and you know, I'm afraid, I believe this one, three men and a baby. Now, there is, it's either, I don't know what it is, it's a single frame in Three Men and a Baby that would purport to show either a cardboard cutout or a ghost, but it's only one single frame of a boy, and... I don't want to attack this one until we get back, because we're at the top of the hour, but I guess you're going to tell me it's not true, huh?
Yeah, I'm afraid I'm going to have to tell you it's not true.
God, but you know, I've seen the picture, so we'll find out in a moment. Stay where you are, Richard. I'm Art Bell, and this is Coast to Coast AM, talking about urban legends. Are they true? Not usually.
Falling in love was the last thing I had on my mind.
When you hold me in your arms so tight, you let me know everything's all right. I'm hooked on a feeling.
in the Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
Oh, it just has to be true. It has to be. From Three Men and a Baby, we all know there's a ghost in that movie because we've all heard it. And then about a month or two ago, somebody sent me the exact frame, the single one frame in which a little boy appears behind a curtain in Three Men and a Baby. I'm going to have Richard, who's written a book all about urban legends, go and look at this photograph now before he decides to blow this up.
All the good luck.
Ooga chucka, indeed. Because we've got the picture right here. So, if this is not a ghost and this is an urban legend, then somebody has manufactured evidence of a high quality. In fact, if you'll go to my website right now and scroll down to Richard Roper's name, you know, you can read about his book there, and we've got a link to his book on Amazon, so forth and so on. But also, you will now see the photograph, the infamous photograph, apparently, of the ghost in Three Men and a Baby. We've got it up there right now. You'll see it by Richard's name. Go take a look. That would be my advice. Go take a look, and you tell me whether you think it's an urban legend or what you think it is. Well, how important is water? Tonight, the Chicago Sun-Times, Richard Roeper, who has written a really cool book called Urban Legends. And by the way, in the book, he's got gazillions of urban legends that you can read all about. Many more than we're going to have time to talk about tonight. So this would be like the Bible on urban legends, I guess. So if you want to be able to tell somebody they're full of it when they tell you the latest story, this is a book you want. And I ought to hold it up on the webcam. I will do that here in a minute. Nice, really nice book. However, here we have a problem. Because, as you know, I've talked a lot about ghosts on this program. People have called and talked about Three Men and a Baby. A single frame, supposedly, of motion picture showing a boy behind a curtain. Something that was not real. A ghost. A single frame. Not as part of the movie. Now, I never believed it until a month or two ago when somebody sent me the photograph that you can now see by Richard Roper's name of the boy behind the curtain. Richard, are you there?
I am here, Art.
All right, can you see that?
I can.
All right, now, how can you possibly explain that? I mean, there it is.
Yeah, and that's an absolutely legitimate frame from the movie Three Men and a Baby. That's
it is
Ted Danson. People will see if they go onto the website there, and I believe that's Celeste Holm, the actress who played his mother, and they're holding up the little baby in
Three
Men and a Baby, and clearly visible in the background in a very eerie shot is this ghost-like apparition in the curtains there. There's nothing doctored at all about that shot. And when that movie came out, especially when it came out on video, and over the years this story has continued to circulate,
yes.
The story behind it was that the apartment in which the movie was filmed was once occupied by a young couple,
yes.
Who had a 9-year-old boy,
yes.
Who accidentally killed himself.
There you are.
With the father's shotgun.
So there you are.
And that when the movie was filmed, this little boy's ghost appeared in the background.
And there it is.
And there it is. Unfortunately, or perhaps fortunately, given the circumstances, Art, the reality of the story is not quite so dramatic.
Well, let's hear it.
People will remember in the original movie, Three Men and a Baby, that Ted Danson's character was an actor. Now, in the original shooting script for the movie, there was a running joke about him doing dog food commercials, and that those scenes were mostly cut from the film. But he was a kind of a wacky actor who was doing these dog food commercials, and this cardboard cutout about two-thirds of the size of a real human being, of Ted Danson, was on the set.
Yes.
When they filmed this scene, somebody left this cardboard cutout in the window there, and that's actually what you're seeing, is a smaller-sized cardboard cutout version of Ted Danson.
Okay, but is it many frames? In other words, as you watch the movie, do you clearly see that for many frames or just one frame?
I think you see it very briefly, and apparently, you know, as you well know, they're shooting a movie. It might take 3 days to shoot one scene. And perhaps they shot it one day, and somebody noticed the prop, and they got it out of there as they continued shooting the scene. But that is actually the story. It, you know,
how did it make it to the final print then?
Well, you know, sloppiness. Somebody didn't see it there, and really, people didn't notice it when the movie played in theaters. It was only when the movie was on video,
and people could still frame it.
You could still frame it, rewind, take a look at it again, and where this story really falls apart is Three Men and a Baby was actually filmed on a soundstage in Toronto, so it was not even filmed in an actual apartment building. But the delicious part about that story, some people really got into the details on that one, Art, is that supposedly, the mom of this little boy rented the movie because, of course, her apartment was featured in it.
No.
And only when she rented the movie did she see the ghost of her own little boy, and then she supposedly went on the talk show circuit talking about how cruel the producers were to include this image of her ghostly son, and then she supposedly was committed to a mental asylum because she just couldn't handle seeing this ghost in the movie whenever
Holy
it would show up
smokes.
On cable.
Holy smokes. Well, when it came out on video, mm-hmm. is this something, you know, you don't want to accuse a movie studio, of course, or anybody, production company or anybody, or advertising, of perpetrating something like this,
mm-hmm.
but you gotta know, a gazillion people went out and rented that movie to try to find that ghost shot.
Exactly, and we would, of course, never accuse them of perpetuating this.
Never.
But is it a bad thing that it happened to them? I don't think so. It doesn't really hurt the movie for people to say, hey, rent out this mediocre comedy because there's this great ghost scene. And maybe you want to even buy a copy for yourself. So they probably didn't create it, but it probably didn't bother them too much. Sometimes it's not a bad thing to be...
I got one so current that I bet you don't even know about it.
Okay.
You know the movie Mission to Mars?
Mm-hmm.
Well, there are two trailers out there for Mission to Mars right now.
Okay.
One, apparently, this is a story now, one shows the face they concocted to be the face on Mars.
Okay.
Which is not, in fact, the one at Cydonia. And the second trailer talks about, allegedly, a 25-year cover-up by NASA, which, by the way, consulted on the film,
mm-hmm.
and shows the real face at Cydonia. Now, this is a very, very serious rumor going around right now, and of course we're not going to know until the movie actually comes out, but I'm trying to put my hands, and will put my hands, on this second trailer. And then there's all kinds of rumors going around about two separate endings for the movie, one using the real face at Cydonia, mm-hmm. the other using this made-up face, and that man's origin is Mars and all the rest of it. But NASA consulted on this movie.
Right.
So if they, it would be impossible for them to use the real face on Mars, which they scoffed at for years and years.
Well, that's a good one, and you're right. I haven't heard that, but I'm going to be with you in trying to figure this out. I'm going to look into this tomorrow, immediately.
All right. And then, actually, it's a touchstone picture, which is Disney. And Disney has been the victim of a number of urban legends, hasn't it?
Oh, yeah. And of course, going all the way back to the infamous one about good old Walt himself supposedly being frozen, waiting for that one day when they can find the cure for
whatever.
Wait
a minute. You mean he's not?
I don't think so. Although I'd like to believe that you could pay an extra $5 in Disneyland and maybe see Walt frozen, but he's actually, I believe, buried out in California. But the Disney company has been the subject of so many urban legends and rumors, and some of them are internet-based. For example, you often hear about the Disney company offering free vacations to the first 1,000 people who respond to an email, or $500 vouchers, et cetera, et cetera. And they're usually signed by a supposed Walt Disney Jr., Walt's son. Well, there is no Walt Disney Jr. There's a Roy Disney Jr., but of course he would be Roy's son, not Walt's son.
I see.
And he was Walt's nephew. probably more interesting and fascinating, and also more based in truth, are some of the urban legends surrounding subliminal images in Disney films.
Oh, yes.
Animated films.
Yes.
And here's a case where you really have to say they could be true, depending on your interpretation. And your listeners will probably recall some of the controversies about various Disney movies in which, if you look really closely, or if you actually, you know, freeze frame the movie itself, you'll see things, whether it's a image of the word sex in the sky in some clouds of smoke, or perhaps some naughty parts on Jessica Rabbit in the movie Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Oh.
And, you know, it has been kind of determined over the years that certain Disney animators like to have a little fun and maybe sneak something in there once.
So, in other words, you're saying maybe...
I'm saying maybe, and it's sort of like the truth is in the eye of the beholder. Now, in one case...
Well, you've looked, right? So what have you beheld?
I have. All in the name of research, I've spent some time on this. Well, I can give you one case where absolutely there was an image, and that's the movie called The Rescuers, which was released originally in 1977, but was re-released just about 1 year ago in the winter of 1999. And about 38 minutes into the movie... there was a scene where a train is flying through a town, and in the window of a particular building, you can see a topless woman. And you have to actually freeze frame the VCR because it was at exactly 2 frames out of 110,000 frames in the movie. But sure enough, there was this topless gal. And Disney had a recall 3.4 million copies of the movie because of some animator's prank. And they actually did release a statement saying, yep, it's there, and yep, we're sorry, and yep, we're going to recall the movie because this is supposed to be for kids.
And I wonder if the animator is still at Disney.
I have a funny feeling probably not. Probably not.
So that's really true then?
That one's absolutely true.
How many people possess, did it ever get out? Is it on video? I mean, can you...
You know what? There are some copies out there.
Are there?
Most of them were caught before. You know, they're in the stores but hadn't been sold or rented out yet. But, you know, again, you go on the internet, you go on somewhere like eBay, and you can find bootleg copies, if you will, of the original Rescuers with the image in it.
But you think the other ones with the subliminal sex messages and the extra parts on on the rabbit and so forth, what about those?
I think in Who Framed Roger Rabbit that some of the early Laserdisc versions, of, you did see Jessica Rabbit perhaps forgetting to wear her underwear.
You're kidding!
I think that actually did happen, although in the later versions that image is erased. The movie The Little Mermaid, there's a lot of controversy about the minister who performs a wedding between the characters of Prince Eric and Ursula. And some people say that the minister at some point actually looks as if he's becoming physically aroused himself. I say that it's actually his knees that were looking. Those are his knees sticking out from under his tunic. So, but there were a lot of religious groups that said, no, 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 Disney's trying to get away with something here. Same thing with the movie The Lion King. Some people say that you can actually see the letters S-E-X appearing in a cloud of dust at one point. What I'm told is that it's actually the letters SFX, and that somebody...
That would be special effects, right?
Exactly. So somebody was having a little fun just putting SFX for special effects, but ooh, a lot of religious groups got really mad about that. They said, look at Disney, they're trying to tell kids sex is good.
another total... you'd like to find the people who do these things and wring their necks.
Yeah, they put us all to a lot of trouble sometimes, you know, to make these things to go away. And, of course, if you're Disney, you're going, oh, boy, you know, this
is
the
last
thing we need.
I'm sure. And then snuff movies. Now, there was a movie recently, I bet you can name it, about a snuff movie, about this lady had hired a private investigator to have her now a deceased husband investigated to see if he really commissioned a snuff movie. Right?
Yeah, the movie was called 8mm.
Thank you, 8mm, Nicolas Cage.
Right. Yeah, and that really is one of the many examples of a fictional film that kind of takes an urban legend and says, what if? And for years there have been stories going around about these supposed, you know, snuff movie, if the listeners don't know, is a movie in which somebody is actually killed.
In,
you know, for real, not as a dramatic effect.
For somebody's perverted pleasure.
For somebody, yeah, and there are all kinds of stories about European snuff films. And even to this day, I'm hearing from people saying, oh, you're naive to think they don't exist. But in almost every case, in fact, in every case I've been able to find, the supposed snuff movies are just repackaged versions of old horror movies, or they're elaborately staged ruses in which actors participate in this kind of grainy documentary that makes it look as if somebody was actually killed. But
So to the best of your knowledge, there's no such thing as a snuff movie, a real one.
That is absolutely true, to the best of my knowledge. And if anybody's got evidence to the contrary, obviously I'd want to know about it. But
it would be a big story.
It would be a big story.
You know, though, when you consider the perverted human condition in many parts of society today, it just seems sickly possible.
It really does. It really does. And it's come, unfortunately, it's come very close to being a reality. I know there was an infamous case in Canada in which a young couple tortured and killed a babysitter, a teenage babysitter.
There you are.
And there were audio tapes that they made for their sick pleasure that were actually played in court. And there may even have been some video of that. So, technically, have there been these sort of movies? Yes, but they weren't really being distributed for anybody's, sick pleasure. But the kind of world we live in, it's only a matter of time before life or death, in this case, imitates urban legend, and somebody does it just so that they have something like this.
What is the dark side of Oz? Do you mean by that the Wizard of Oz?
Yeah, the Wizard of Oz. And another.
What could be wrong with that, other than the witch getting crunched under the house?
Yeah, unfairly. That witch has been unfairly maligned all these years. Well, the Wizard of Oz is, of course, a beloved film, but also kind of a cult film. There are people who own copies of that movie and study it very, very closely. And there was a story going around, and still goes around, that one of the Munchkin actors hired by the Wizard of Oz hanged himself, committed suicide, and that there's actually a scene where you could see him dangling from a tree. The reality is that...
Yeah, right. Even if that happened, they're going to really include that in the film.
Exactly. Something so sick happened where the Munchkin would hang himself from a tree. You'd think they'd say, cut, and, let Judy Garland go back to her trailer and have a quick drink and try to get over it.
That's right.
But it was actually a bird flapping its wings in such a way that almost makes it look like somebody's hanging from a tree. So that one's been going around for a long time. It's not
Well, how
true.
Does a bird flapping its wings look like a person hanging from a tree? I don't
know. That's what I said when I watched it, Art, because to tell you the truth, I didn't think it looked like it that much. But there are people who see it and they go, that's a Munchkin swinging from a tree. And I'm like... No, that's an exotic bird flailing its wings.
Boy, so many bubbles burst. All right, hold on, Richard. We're at the bottom of another hour. They go very quickly. So many urban legends, so little time. I'm Art Bell, and of course, this is the unpredictable Coast to Coast AM.
She's got something that moves my soul, and she knows I love to love her. But she lets me down every time. Can't make her mine. She's no one's lover tonight. With me she'll be so inviting. I want her all for myself. Oh, temptation eyes. Looking through my soul. Temptation eyes. You got to love me. You got to love me.
With a tear in every room, all I want's the love you promise beneath the haloed moon. But you think I should be happy with your money and your name, and hide myself in sorrow while you play your cheating game. Silver thread.
Call Art Bell from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. The wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. And to call Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
You know, I'm still not sure about three men and a baby. That picture is very suspicious. So, you know, if you think about it, even I am not quite convinced that it's total bunk. Believe it or not. But I guess it is. That's what we're talking about right now is urban legends. My guest is Richard Roeper. He wrote a book on the subject called Urban Legends. You can get it. Go to my website. Scroll down to his name. It'll take you to Amazon.com where you can get it real cheap. Total bummer. We've only got Richard till the top of the hour because he's got to get up like really early in the morning and do something. So I'm going to ask him about two that you have faxed to me, two urban legends, and then, actually three, very quickly, and then we're going to go to the phones. Richard?
Yes, sir.
All right. Here's one for you.
Okay.
That American Airlines always has one non-Christian pilot or co-pilot on board any aircraft they fly, in case of the rapture.
Ooh, that's a good one. I'd love to hear more about that. That one I don't know, but I like it.
You like it?
I like it a lot.
All right.
That could be in the sequel, Art.
Here's one. That pull tabs from pop cans are helping buy some kid a kidney. If true, he could have been dead 10 years ago. Should have been.
Yeah. They've been collecting pull tabs for this kid for the last 15 or 20 years. And that's another one of those unfortunate ones where people are trying to perform a good deed, and it's like, you know, there ain't anybody out there who wants those pull tabs. I don't know how to tell those kids.
All right, and this one more complex. Just heard this one. Two duck hunters in Minnesota go hunting in the winter on a frozen lake with their new Jeep Cherokee. They are going to use dynamite to blow a hole in the ice and then shoot ducks, which will land in the open water.
Yeah.
One guy throws the dynamite, but his dog chases after it. The retriever grabs a stick of dynamite, begins running toward the men, thinking quickly but shaking. The other man shoots the dog, but barely hits it, and the poor, scared, shot dog runs under the Jeep, which is then blown up and sinks along with the killed dog.
That one I have heard, and you know, it's a funny one. It sounds a little bit more like a Roadrunner Wile E. Coyote cartoon than actual, but I like that one.
So that one, you cannot confirm nor deny that one.
I cannot confirm that, although I hear Jesse Ventura might have been involved up there in that one in Minnesota.
And then there's one that we've got to kill, and then we'll go to the. I lied a little. It's poor Richard Gere.
Oh my gosh.
The gerbil story about Richard Gere.
Yeah, it's the longest relationship of his life has been with this gerbil. Poor Richard, this story's been going around for 20 years. And, you know, there are so many people who swear they know the nurse who was in the emergency room the day he was wheeled in with this gerbil in a very uncomfortable place. And I always say, oh, gosh, well, then put that nurse in touch with me. And, of course, once again, that nurse doesn't exist because the story never happened. But, man, that story's been around for about 15, 20 years.
And he must seriously suffer from that. I mean, that's a terrible story.
Yeah, it's a mean-spirited story, obviously. And you know, Richard Gere has that whole Zen thing going on. So he refuses to ever talk about it, which just makes people say, hey, look, he's never denied it. Well, he's never confirmed it either. He just won't dignify it.
Well, that's one way to handle it. I'm not sure if it's a good way, because when you refuse to comment on it, it only gives it more power.
I think you're absolutely right.
Yeah.
I think you got to address these things head on.
All right. Well, let's head on to some calls. Wildcard Line, you're on the air with Richard Roeper. Hello.
Hello, Arbell?
Yes, sir. Where are you?
I'm here at Naples, Illinois.
Okay.
I listen to you at 5:50 a.m. off St. Louis.
Yes, sir.
I have a question for Richard. Has he ever, on a three men and a baby, has he ever watched it past where you see the figurine in the window? You know how the movie will fan right?
Mm-hmm.
And usually most people stop it, but if you watch it further in slow motion as they've come back past the window, the figurine is gone, And if you look in the left-hand corner by the curtain, there is a shotgun sitting stock or stock down with the barrel up in that corner.
I know what you're talking about. It does seem to be a shotgun, and I guess, again, I think it has something to do with the continuity where something was left there. And it really is, when you think about it, for a major motion picture, really sloppy filmmaking.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what, I'll take a look at it one more time. And there is something, as you mentioned, Art, there's something eerie about that picture, even when you know the truth. I don't know. It does have a strange look to it.
It's just hard to buy that in the editing process, they could get a frame in there like that. It's just, it's hard to buy. I mean, I guess anything can happen. So
it's almost easier to believe that it's a ghost than that many people in a professional level would allow such a mistake to appear. It almost really is.
Well, when you consider the editing process itself,
yeah,
it's in an ongoing shot. So I give up. I don't know. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Richard Roeper, Urban Legends. Hi.
Hi, Art. Hi, Richard.
Hi.
Art, this one might be your favorite one.
Okay.
With Unsolved Mysteries, the little children pushing the car over the railroad tracks.
This is no urban legend. Well, as far as I know, it is, or I've been propagating it.
Okay.
But there is a story which has been reported in the newspapers in San Antonio, Texas.
Mm-hmm.
There was
Richard, are you familiar with this one?
I need to hear more about
okay,
it.
Okay, here it comes. And so a school bus was on the railroad tracks, and a train collided with it. It was a horrible tragedy. A bunch of children were killed. And the story is that if you park your car on the railroad tracks
mm-hmm.
and just put it in neutral, that little hands, people have put talcum powder on the back of their cars, little hands will leave prints and your car will move off the railroad tracks.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I wouldn't discount that one, and I don't know. I don't know if I'd want to give that test myself out there on the railroad tracks, but...
And Art and Richard, with this baseball one that's been bugging me for years, Richard, is anyone buried under home plate in any stadium or under any of the bases?
Well, we still haven't found Jimmy Hoffa, have we?
Oh, come on. You know what I mean.
The rumors about people being buried under home plate, or in Jimmy Hoffa's case, maybe the end zone at the Meadowlands have been around forever, but
right.
They've never been able to dig up any evidence.
Well, okay. they couldn't. He'd be in concrete.
There you go. No, as far as I know, it's not true.
All right.
All right.
All right. Thank you, ma'am. So, but he's somewhere.
He is somewhere.
He might be
working with Elvis at Burger King, bro. We know.
Yeah, Elvis stories. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Richard Roeper. Hi. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, there you are, sir.
Yes. This story or something similar to it has been around for a long time. Somebody's driving their car, and suddenly a person appears in the front seat and... issues some kind of an apocalyptic message, like, you know, the end is near, or...
Well, there's another version of that story in which the person is a hitchhiker.
Yeah, or a hitchhiker.
And then picked up, and they issue the apocalyptic story, and then they disappear.
Yeah, suddenly they're out of the car.
Oh, yeah, there's
moving.
A lot of stories about that.
Yeah, it's been... I just wonder if Richard's heard anything like that.
I have, and you know, in various neighborhoods, they give the ghost different names, and they, you know, sometimes refer to it as the vanishing hitchhiker. And
yeah.
Again, you know, that's a tough one to really call an urban legend, because I believe that things like that can absolutely happen. And I think, you know, is it possible? Yeah. Can any of us ever prove that it happened? No. And the only other thing is that it seems to have happened in so many different towns that you got to believe that in many cases it's just a local piece of folklore and it didn't really happen.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
All right, what about this Nike shoe rebate thing?
Oh, yeah. Boy, all you have to do is send them your old shoes, and they'll send you a pair of new shoes, according to the urban legend, at least. And that's another one where a company gets besieged by these well-meaning emails and responses from people who really believe that Nike's giving away free shoes. Well, you know, if they did that, they'd kind of go out of business at some point. They're going to have to do more than just get your old shoes.
But, well, I think the big question is, if you call Nike and say, how many shoes do you get back,
yeah,
demanding the offer, what do they say?
They call you bad names and hang up on you because, you know, that's how many shoes they've received.
I see. All right. We'll see what damage they can do, folks. First-time caller line, you're on the air with Richard Roeper and Art Bell. Good morning.
Morning.
Hi.
This is Brent from Flagstaff, Arizona.
Flagstaff, all right.
Yes. Well, to get back to Walt Disney, on the cover of The Little Mermaid, there's a picture of a male's genitalia on the cover.
Yeah, there's some structure in the background that looks really, really like male genitalia. And, you know, they denied that cover art looked like that, yet they changed that in subsequent versions of the video. So whether or not it was intentional, it sure looked like that's what you were seeing there. So they did rectify the situation.
All right.
Well, I have another one. Mm-hmm. Now, this is a total urban legend. My friend told me this, and he heard it from another friend, that on the Internet, there's a man who actually showed live human mutilation over the Internet.
Yeah, that's a version of the snuff film legend. There are all sorts of little grainy films you can supposedly see. But you're right. You're hearing an urban legend there.
All right. It is one. Wild Card Line, you're on the air with Richard Roeper. Good morning.
Hello, Art. This is Charles from Eagle River, Alaska.
Hello there, Charles.
Hey, I broke my arm the same day you did, hang gliding.
Really?
Yes, I did. Okay, I got an urban legend, I believe, a long time ago. You know the singing group Ohio Players?
Sure.
On their soundtrack, Roller Coaster of Love, there's a scream in the background, and it said that a woman was murdered when they were recording that. They didn't. Mm-hmm.
Now, I believe you actually have hit on one that Richard wrote about.
Yeah,
oh, really?
Yeah, that's a good one. The Love Roller Coaster Death Scream, which actually is also mentioned in the movie Urban Legend. One of the characters is telling a girl this story, and the funky hit from the 70s, Love Roller Coaster, does have this very eerie, high-pitched scream at one point on it. And the rumor, you know, these things get so detailed, it was supposedly the woman who actually appears on the cover of the album, dripping in honey, and she supposedly had suffered some burns from the modeling session, and she was so mad that she showed up enraged and showed up at the studio wielding a knife and then was disarmed and stabbed to death herself by the manager of the group, and they loved the sound of her death so much they supposedly put it on the song. And of course, none of this is true.
Oh, it's not true.
No, and actually, the other rumor about that one is that because the song was called Love Roller Coaster, that you're actually hearing the sound of a woman who was killed on a roller coaster in an accident, and they had obtained that tape and they were using it.
Okay, so the whole thing's bogus then.
It's totally bogus.
See what happens. See how people sound when you burst this bubble?
I know, I feel bad. I'm the Grinch who stole the urban legend.
Oh, man.
Thank you, caller. You
Bye.
Take care. Old man is right.
He's heartbroken in Alaska.
You can tell. All right, east of the Rockies, you're on the air with Richard Roeper. Where are you, please?
Hi, Art. Rich, this is Mike from Niagara Falls, USA.
Okay.
Enjoying the show tonight. And just three quick points I wanted to make and actually a question to follow up. Number one, Richard, not to take away from your book or anything, but there's a great website called Snopes.com.
Yeah, absolutely. Terrific website.
And somebody's put an awful lot of time into this because they kind of go into the psyche of the urban legends and things like that.
I think it's a great, probably the best urban legends website. There are tons of them out there, but Snopes is probably the best.
The one thing that they mentioned on there regarding the KFC thing is that actually Kentucky Fried Chicken did put out the press release that because of the whole fried thing,
right,
that they were going to. But is it true or is it like an extension of the legend that Kentucky is now trying to charge people for using the state's name, i.e. the Run for the Roses? Kentucky Derby has now been changed from the Kentucky Derby 2 Run for the Roses. Have you ever heard that?
I have not heard that, but I'd have a hard time believing they'd be able to enforce such a regulation. Sounds like an urban legend in the making to me.
It does. It does, and it's on Snopes. So that and two like urban legends, and then I'll let you go. The first was, I think, theater seat cushions with infected needles. And then the new one, the one that I've received a couple of times, is be careful of these using a payphone.
Right.
Needles in the coin return and then some sort of spray or something that's put on the receivers themselves.
Oh, yeah.
My God.
Yeah, the tainted needles in the payphones is a popular, relatively new urban legend. And that's one of the rare cases where the urban legend has been copied by real life. There were a couple of pranksters in West Virginia last year who did start leaving needles, not tainted with any deadly disease, but they did think it was funny to leave some hypodermic needles in the slots of some payphones in response to the police saying that it was an urban legend in the first place. So now it's true, but it's only true because they heard it as a rumor.
Now, there was a movie about urban legends in which the plot was some character acting out all the urban legends.
Right.
For real.
Right. Yeah, and the movie was simply called Urban Legend. And actually, they're making the sequel as we speak. Urban Legend 2 will be out this summer. And I don't have anything technically to do with the movies, but it's kind of a clever idea.
You should be a consultant.
I'm waiting for their call.
All right. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Richard Roeper. Hi.
Hey, Art. I just wanted to make a comment. I'm calling from Los Angeles.
Yes, sir.
And I work in the movie industry.
Mm-hmm.
And about it being sort of shoddy filmmaking and stuff, you would be amazed at what gets through the editing process as far as little mistakes and things left out of place and things that don't match and
right.
things like that.
So you're saying it's absolutely possible that
Oh, absolutely, 100%, yeah. You get crews that are trying to do X number of shots a day and trying to do so many things at once, and it... sometimes the little things get missed.
Sure.
There's actually whole books on little flubs. And
right.
Really famous one is Raiders of the Lost Ark, when he falls down into the pit and he lands and the cobra's right in front of him. You can see the reflection of the cobra in the glass that they're using to separate between him and the snake.
You're kidding.
No. If you watch it, you can see it.
Well, that's interesting, and it might tell us how some urban legends get started, I guess. So little time. First-time caller line, you're on the air with Richard Roeper. Hi.
Hi. I'm originally from San Antonio. I'm calling from Idaho. However, what I'm calling about is the train tracks.
Yes.
It is actually a true story, and all the streets around the train tracks are named for the kids that died in the accident.
Yeah, I believe that's right. I really think that's a true story.
That really is. Also, in San Antonio, there's also a story about the donkey lady, and there's a certain phone number that you can call, and if you call the number, a female voice will answer. It will sound like a female voice, but it will sound like a female voice hee-hawing like a donkey does.
Really?
I was never able to get a hold of the number to find out what it was, but apparently there's also a donkey lady in the San Antonio area. And that goes along with the urban legend of the train tracks and putting the talcum powder on the train tracks. But what it actually is with the tracks is it's gravity that's pulling you, because it is at a slight slope.
Well, how about the story of the talcum powder on the back of the cars with the kids' handprints?
Well, we did put the talcum powder on the cars. I have actually been out to the tracks. We did put the powder out.
You've done this?
Yes, I have.
Wow.
It was in San Antonio.
And
it's on the south side of San Antonio in the
how about the handprints?
Well, they didn't show up.
But the car
did move. That there were no prints on the car.
Okay, I've got you. I appreciate that. Thank you. One more, maybe. Wild card line, you're on the air with Richard Roeper. Hi.
Yes, hello. Good morning, Art.
Good morning.
This is Michael in Philadelphia.
Yes, Michael.
Yes, good evening, Richard.
Hi, how you doing?
Pretty good. Okay, I got two questions about urban legends. Do you have any good urban legends about UFOs or aliens? And I'll hang up for the answer. Thank you. Bye.
All right. You're welcome.
Well, I'll tell you that when it comes to UFOs and aliens, the reason I didn't even get into them in the first book is there are so many. And, I mean, obviously there are, so many books that could be done.
Richard Roswell?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if that's not an urban legend to me.
It isn't to me either. And apparently to the Air Force, because they had a press conference. Really stupid, too. Do you ever see that Air Force press conference on Roswell?
Yeah.
It's like they were trying to get people to believe in the whole thing.
Exactly.
So dumb.
What,
I don't know what they're trying to accomplish there.
All right, so for the rest of all the fun and the truth about urban legends, you should get Urban Legends by Richard Roeper. You can go to my website, linked over on Amazon.com right now, and they sell really cheap, don't they?
I think they got a pretty good deal on Amazon there, Art.
Yeah, they do about 30% off. Otherwise, bookstores across America. Richard, I know you've got to get up early in the morning. Thank you so much.
Art, thank you. It was a pleasure.
Good night.
Good night.
So next time you hear something that sounds like it should be true, don't you necessarily believe it.
Shouldn't have been a messin', and now someone else is getting all your best. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days, these boots are gonna walk all over you.
Wanna take a ride? Call Art Bell from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at area code 775-727-1222. Or call the wildcard line at 775-727-1295. To talk with Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
And you know what? This one is not an urban legend. They played this again and again and again at Waco. And if you listen to the words, it's pretty chilling. They played it again and again and again. You got to sit and actually have to listen to the words of this. Kind of thing I'm talking about. Good morning, everybody. I'm Art Bell, and in a moment, we're going to talk with the famous man, I think famous man, who sits out in the middle of the desert sometimes for days or even weeks on end and talks to people who call a certain telephone booth out there. I finally got him on the line. Coming up next. Don't like the darkness? Don't blame you. Well, 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 would you look at what I just received, a fax. It says, hello, Art. I am the madman in the desert who camps for days at a time at the Mojave Desert phone booth. This is a phone booth out in the middle of nowhere, I guess. I've wanted to chat with you for a few years now, but I have always suspected the government monitors all your calls. Well, sure they do. This was confirmed for me when Mel from Washington called you, and also the guy from Area 51 who warned of triangle-shaped ones. But now I just don't care anymore. I wish so much that you could have gotten through to me on my last trip to the desert. Now, I did try, some of you will recall. I am 40 years old now and would like to tell you all of my experiences, especially what I just went through in the desert last week, the closest, in quotes, they ever came. I'm at the phone booth in the desert often. I'm going back soon. I'll stay for a week at a time. I live in Concord, California. His name is Desert Chad, and he's got a website, which we can tell you about in a moment. Here is, he says, now he could be an urban legend. Maybe he's an urban legend. I don't know. Here's Desert Chad. Chad, hello.
Good evening, Art.
Are you real?
Yes, I am.
You are really the guy who goes out. Where in the hell is this phone booth?
This phone booth is sitting on a plateau 4,200 feet up in the middle of a Joshua Tree forest on an old mining road off of I-15, as say you're going from Baker, California into Vegas.
Right.
To the right. There's three different ways to get up there. I believe a rancher has one of the ways blocked at the moment. I would suggest four-wheel drive, even though I don't have a four-wheel drive.
Why would anybody put a phone booth in a place where you'd need a four-wheel drive vehicle to get to it?
Well, I'll tell you, Art, there used to be a mine up there in the 60s, and the phone company put that phone in there so the miners would be able to call home to their families.
Oh!
And I believe it was 1968 that the mine closed, and the phone company never bothered to went up there and take the phone out.
You're kidding. So that phone booth, to this very day, remains there.
That phone booth, yes. It's an old, like a 1964 model. All the glass is shot out of it. It's in a billion shards all around it. There's holes in the frame. The door's ripped off. I met a local rancher, because I camp out there regularly, Charlie, and he was telling me that it was the oddest thing. This phone company came up there in 1977 and put a push button in and then left. And he laughed because there's no traffic on this road.
Right.
It's 15 miles from the nearest pavement.
They actually upgraded the phone.
Yes.
Well, the phone company is a big company, and you can imagine the bureaucracy in a phone company would send this poor slob up into the middle of nowhere to replace the phone and upgrade it.
And he's probably wondering, what the hell am I doing this for?
I'm sure he was. So there's actually a modern push-button phone there.
Yes, there is.
And nobody's ripped it out or destroyed it?
No, and Art, it rings 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, from around the world. I talk to Switzerland. I talk to Australia, Africa. Of course, I talk to Kansas, Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Well, why, gee, a million wise, why do people call from all over the world? How do they even know to call this phone booth in the middle of nowhere?
I'm not really sure I don't understand how fast the phenomenon swept up. But it's only been recently starting to appear in magazines. I'll be out there camping, Art, for instance, and in one day, I have to take the phone off the hook at night to sleep, and I can't sleep.
You're kidding.
I know, and I feel guilty about that.
It rings that much.
It rings that much, and I feel guilty about taking it off the hook, but I feel guilty if it's ringing and I don't get out of my van and answer it.
So in other words, when I called you, it was about a week and a half ago, I think, I actually dialed it on the air, and all I could get was a busy signal.
I was talking to the world.
You were actually awake at that hour?
I get up in the mornings before the sun comes up, get my coffee on, I put the phone on receiver, and I have stood in that phone booth to up to 3:08, from 7 to 3.
7 in the morning till?
3 in the morning.
Till 3 in the morning?
Yes. I leave the phone booth. I can't speak for 3 days.
Chad, why do you do this?
I really don't know. I mean, I had a caller from a guy in Toledo, Ohio, who said, what the hell are you doing standing in the middle of a desert answering a payphone? And I said, sir, what are you doing calling a payphone in the middle of the desert?
To which he replied,
he said, I don't know. And I said, well, you know, I really don't know why I'm here. What does it all mean? You know, we came to the conclusion that it's just, you know, people just want to connect. And that is just an extremely unique way to do it. I mean, we have the internet, and you can sit in your house, and you can talk to the world. There is just something so unique about standing in the middle of nowhere on a plateau talking to Australia.
Well, yeah.
And women from Paris, France.
Women from Paris?
Oh, women from Paris, women from Germany, women from Tahiti.
Really?
Oh, the girls from Tahiti just laugh and laugh and laugh and just scream, we love American men.
We love American men? Have you ever met anybody that you have talked to on that phone?
Actually, I have. I've talked, I was up there for the millennium, and as a few of the callers coming in, they're really intrigued that I was standing out there in the middle of nowhere.
I mean, especially the girls from France.
Well, yeah, some of the girls from France have my cell phone number now, and they said when they learn better English, they're going to call me.
You've got to be kidding.
No.
So you never know. You could meet your mate.
Oh, definitely. You can meet some really unique people out there. I mean, this one guy from Germany called, and I like to ask him what their name is, where they're calling from, and just, you know, questions about their life. And this guy told me he couldn't tell me his real name. He called himself Cinderella. Said he was wanted by the FBI. He was the Antichrist. He was into satanic things. I mean, they get some wild calls. And I'll hang up the phone, and the next call will be like a 10-year-old innocent little girl from Germany who I can't even understand her name. It's amazing.
How does this phone number of this phone booth get passed around the world? I suppose the internet, huh?
I think it's on the internet now, but before it was passed, I guess it got picked up on the AP service. LA Times reported this little small article on it, and it spread from there. Like one day, I hung up the phone, Art, and I got about 25 calls in a row from Scotland. I started asking these people, where are you getting this number?
Right, right.
And they say, it was in our morning paper. I talked to a guy from Istanbul, Hungary, who got the number out of a small underground rock magazine. I mean, it's just unbelievable where these people are getting the number from.
Well, you know, Chad, there are some, Desert Chad, there are some who would say that if you meet your mate in a situation like that, where you're in the middle of a phone booth and she's in, Jamaica, whatever, and you end up getting married, that the two of you would absolutely deserve each other and have a hell of a story about the way you met.
Oh, you bet.
How long have you been doing this now?
You know, actually, Art, the first time I've ever been to the desert in my life was for the millennium. I'm always usually at the beach. I like to ocean surf, and I ocean kayak and surf and stuff. And I was thinking, not really worst case scenario. I didn't really give a damn if the computers went down, the power went out. You know, I'm still alive. That's cool. What I was worried about was like all the crazy people, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't want to be in a situation and caught up and get caught in the crossfire. So I'm looking at a map of California where I live, and I'm trying to find the safest place to go. And I'm thinking, well, the desert, there's no one out there. So I go to the bookstore, and I read everything I can on the Mojave Desert, the plant life, the weather temperature, everything, the animals.
Trying to figure out whether you could survive.
Yeah, and then I packed up 2 weeks, 3 weeks worth of food, about a month's worth of water, all the firewood I can get. I did run out of firewood 3 nights before I left, but thank God a rancher came through for me. So I just packed up, and I took off, and I found that plateau, and I'm driving up this old mining road, and I'm just tearing the hell out of my van. And I come around this bend, and there is this phone booth, and it's just so odd. I'm looking.
So then, did you actually begin all of this? I mean, this is almost, we talked about urban legends before I got you on the phone. This is almost in the category of the urban legend, you know, the phone booth out in the middle of the desert with the guy who talks to people from around the world.
Yeah.
But you're saying it's no legend, it's really true.
It is really true, it is there. I live in that thing.
You live in it?
Basically, most of my days when I'm in the desert, I'm standing in that booth.
Other people would ask, but you must not have a life.
Well, I have a very, very, very busy life. I find time, you know, I have to have a week or 2 weeks off at a time just to be away from everything.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I'm really not away from everything because that damn phone just won't stop ringing.
It's
just too interesting. I can't let it go, Art.
Have others... it's like a compulsion.
Yeah.
I guess. All right, have others taken up your cause? In other words, do others know specifically where the phone booth is? Is it a crowd to get to that booth now to sit there and answer it?
No, it's not yet. But you know what? The popularity of it is spreading so fast, I'm afraid it's going to be its death. Because if people start trailing up past those ranchers' houses. They've been living up there, you know, in isolation for years and years and years. And
yeah,
there's a parade coming by their house pretty soon.
They're not going to like it.
Yeah, I read an article in the L.A. Times not long ago. It said Mojave Rangers declare war on the booth. War on the booth.
What?
The Rangers I have met have been very nice to me.
Why would they not... Well, because they don't want people spoiling the area environmentally.
Yeah, it's a natural preserve, and it's an out-of-way place where tourists don't usually go, so if people start crowding there, that means they have to go out of their way to drive 15 miles up that road just to make sure everything's all right at least once a day.
15 miles.
So I'm sure it's 15 miles from the nearest paved road.
Boy, that would not be easy to find.
No, it's not easy to find. I just found it by sheer luck.
Did you disseminate the number, Chad, or... Now, I know you've got a website, right?
Yes. And that was totally unexpected.
It's members.zoom, xoom.com/DesertChad, right?
And then a forward slash after Desert, forward slash Desert Chad, forward slash.
Desert Chad twice?
Yeah, no, there's a forward slash after the word
Desert,
Chad.
After Desert Chad,
yeah.
C-H-A-D.
And you don't have to type in triple W.
So another, yeah, but what I'm wondering here is, are you the one that got this started, or was it already going?
No, it was already going, because, Art, this is a crazy thing. When I came around the bend, and I seen the booth, the phone was ringing, and I park my van and I get out and it's just ringing, and I'm looking around 360 degrees, there is nothing, and this phone is ringing. I thought,
you're looking for somebody who's going to answer, right?
I picked it up. It was New Zealand.
New Zealand.
The very first call. I'm standing in the middle of the desert looking at Joshua trees. A couple of cows walk by me. I'm talking to a lady in New Zealand.
About what?
She was asking me about the weather there. Why is it really in the desert? Is it real? A lot of overseas callers, I had a guy from Scotland call me and said he heard a rumor that it was in downtown Vegas, and it was all a joke. And I told him no, and I explained to him it is real. And I sent him a picture of it. I got his address. I took a picture of me.
Oh, that's a good question. By the way, are there pictures of it on your website?
Yes, I have 27 pictures of my adventures out there.
You do?
Just over the millennium, yes. I have a lot more I want to put up, but I've been busy at work. There's a lot.
Oh, so you do work then?
Yes. I'm a subcontractor, so I can work when I want. I just contract myself out to various companies, and
I see.
It allows me to do what I want.
So you can then devote your spare time to your hobby.
Yes, I have more spare time than most
people,
yeah, because I'm not really chasing after money. I could give a damn about that.
Has anybody who's called ever, you know, either solicited you for money or sent you money or just plain solicited you?
No one's ever solicited me, but people have sent me gifts in the mail. I talked to a record producer in Istanbul, and he sent me some CDs.
A record producer in Istanbul, Turkey.
And I talked to a fireman in Columbus, Ohio, who's sending me a fire hat from the station he lives in. And this is a good one, Art. Yes, right before I left,
the
day before yesterday, I picked up the phone, and it was a company who distributes guitars and violins. And the whole company has been interested in that phone, been calling for months, and it just rings off the hook and no one ever answers. I picked it up. I talked to them for 5 minutes. They're sending me a guitar.
No.
Yes. Now I'm not saying, you know, if anybody goes up there, you're going to get showered with gifts. I mean, that's just a couple little trinkets I got, but I sit there weeks at a time, or days at a time, I'm sorry.
How many of the people that call on the phone think you're crazy and ought to be called Crazy Chad?
Well, a lot of them. You know, I get a lot of calls from Florida, and they're just shocked that someone answers the phone, and they all say the same thing. You're a nut. They love that word nut down there. You're a nut. You're a nut. And I can't believe people just
I can't believe
you're standing in the desert.
I suppose the best comeback is, well, what are you doing calling me?
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, you just want to connect. It's just it's a crazy thing.
Do you get more guys or more girls?
I get, it goes in waves. I get a lot of female callers from France, and then all of a sudden I'll get all these drunken guys from Scotland. Oh, I get this guy.
Drunken guys from Scotland?
Yeah, I get a lot of guys that calls from bars, and
But occasionally you do get the female, right?
Oh, I get lots of females. Yeah.
Okay, Chad, hold on. All right.
Okay.
Okay, stay right there.
Hello, baby. Yeah, this is the Big Bopper speaking.
Anybody out there know Chad?
Will I?
Of course I will.
Oh, baby, you know what I like.
We'll be right back.
Chantilly lace and a pretty face and a ponytail hanging down. Wiggle in the walk and a giggle in the talk. Make the world go round. Ain't nothing in the world like a big-eyed girl to make me act so funny. Make me spend my money. Make me feel
long neck goose like a girl. Oh, baby, that's the one I like. What's that, baby? Come on, show you how to sing the blues.
Seatbelt in the Kingdom of Nye. From west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. Or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Networks.
Well, Richard Roeper from the Chicago Sun-Times, who wrote Urban Legends, said, I'm an urban legend. I am, and so is my guest, Desert Chad. Can you imagine sitting out there in the middle of the night, in the cold, in the desert, by a phone booth that nobody knows about, or maybe everybody knows about, and taking calls from all over the world for who knows what reason, except to have a lot of fun. Desert Chad, he's my guest. Now to my guest, whose name is Desert Chad. That's what we call him. And he How frequently, Chad, do you, I guess, pack up your supplies and head for the desert?
Now,
first of all, where are you now?
I'm at home now. I'm in Concord, California.
Concord, California. All right.
Yeah.
All right. How often do you pack up and...
Well, I'll tell you, after I went up there for a week over the millennium, I came back and I couldn't get out of my head. I was trying to concentrate on my work, and I just couldn't do it. And I only lasted about 3 or 4 weeks, and I took off again. And I stayed up there 5, 6, 7 days. I'm not really sure how many days. After a while, it's surreal.
I mean, don't you get sunburned standing there?
Right now, my nose is about to peel off my face. I forgot to put my sunscreen on.
You can't do that. I mean, the desert will kill you.
Oh, yes, it will.
So what do you bring with you?
I bring a lot of potatoes, prepackaged snack foods, and dehydrated fruit, and things like that, and lots of water to cook and to bathe with. I just heat the water on the stove, and, you know, I'm out in the desert by myself, so I just strip down naked and...
Naked?
Yeah, and sponge bath myself off. I've actually stood in the booth naked and took calls.
Really?
Once, for about 20 minutes. It got really cold.
Did you... The desert has unique characteristics. In other words, during the day, it warms up very nicely, and it's like a spring day in most places, a lot of times. And then at night, the minute the sun goes down, as you must well know, it gets cold out there, baby, and if the wind's blowing... It is really cold.
You know it. I've never seen temperature extremes swing like that. You know, I'm watching this beautiful, beautiful sunset setting over these volcanic cinder cones. I'm standing out there going, this is beautiful. It's about 55 degrees. And the second I can't see the sun, it feels like it's 20 degrees. I couldn't believe it. I'm just freezing to death.
Okay, I'm going to try something here, Chad.
Okay.
Just for grins. Here we go. Now, let's see what happens. What I'm doing is I'm ringing that phone booth right now. I'm going to ring.
Oh, my scarce competitor.
Probably not going to be anybody there now, huh?
No.
Are there others like you, though, that are doing this now? I mean, do you have even one or two other...
I'll tell you, Art, some people come up and just spend like a few hours answering the phone and leave. Some people will come up and camp like one night with me, but then they always leave because it's a harsh environment. People can only take it a short period of time.
So you've got to be prepared for an odyssey.
You have to be very prepared.
Uh-huh. If there was somebody up there, they could conceivably be in a car or a vehicle like yours hearing the phone ring right now.
And they would have to answer it. Once you answer the phone one time, you can't not...
You can't not answer
not
it.
Just let it ring. You would take it off the hook first.
It drives me nuts hearing a phone ring that I don't pick up.
Well, I'm just... Picture it right now, Art. It's in the middle of the desert. It's night, there's no lights, there's no cars, there's no traffic, and there's a phone ringing right now.
Right now. That's
right now. There's coyotes probably scattering.
Yeah, probably scattering. Because there's no glass left in the phone booth.
No.
So in other words, when you're standing there, you're subject to the wind and the cold and whatever else.
Yes, when it gets very windy, I have a tarp, and I tarp the booth off on three sides, and I tape an umbrella over the top of it sometimes into the doorway.
I see.
And I got a little stool, and I sit in there with... I light candles up at night because there's no light, so you got to bring a lot of candles and tape them all over the booth.
So then you're just sort of like a... If somebody were to see you at a distance, it'd probably look pretty ghostly, you there with the candles burning in the middle of nowhere.
Oh, I bet it would.
Well, there's one other aspect I want to ask you about this, and that is, because of where you're going, we all know this part of the world. I live adjacent to Area 51.
Yes, I know.
And if you spend a lot of nights in the desert, alone, in the cold, in the dark, then you must have seen stuff while you were out there.
Well, yes, Art, I have, actually.
Like what?
Well, over the millennium, I knew that place, you know. And they,
wait a minute.
Not answering. Please try your call later. We're sorry, but your call will now be disconnected. 113T.
Yeah, there you are, see? Nobody answered.
Art. Over the millennium when I was there, for two nights, I seen these lights that I've seen a few times, maybe three or four times in the past, at isolated beaches along the north coast. They're little orbs, and they change colors really violently. I mean, it's like...
Oh, it's amazing that you would talk about orbs, because a guest of mine, Peter Davenport, all of a sudden we're getting all these orb reports, orange glowing frequently.
Oh, Art, in 92, I seen an orb very close, and this... I want to call it a cloud, but it looked like a fake cloud. It's kind of a dirty cloud, and it was oscillating so fast back and forth. I could see the trails of it. It was moving so quick, and this it was only maybe four, five, six telephone poles high. These stacked telephone poles on end to end.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, when are you going back next? For everybody out there who might want to connect with you in the middle of nowhere,
I will be going back with. Possibly within 2 weeks. Inside of 2 weeks, yes. I'm going to try to bust my butt at work and get some money together and pay a few bills and then take off.
Aren't you worried that, like, maybe some forest rangers or something will come by and talk to you for a while, and you'll tell them what they're doing, and they will take you in for a real quick examination?
Art, anytime I see a uniform, I panic.
Well, I mean, they're going to say... Typical cop of any kind is going to say, "Hi there, what are you doing? What you doing out here?" And you're going to say, "Well, I come out here and camp to answer this phone when it rings." See, at that point, they're going to start thinking psychiatric evaluation.
Exactly. I've always been slightly worried about that. So far, it's been cool.
You mean they actually understand?
Yeah, the one ranger. One ranger, he's been really nice. Actually, you know, I can sit up there for days and not see a ranger because it's not on the beaten path. You can sit up there for a week and they might come by once.
Well, that's all it would take.
Yeah. Well, the last time I got really lucky, I mean, the guy rolled by and he was a young guy and he had a big smile on his face and he just kind of waved and I waved back and I was just thinking, keep going.
Keep going. Please,
yeah.
Keep going. You know, I can sort of imagine a dialogue. Young fellow, this is really interesting what you're doing. Have a seat here in the back of the car, and we're gonna let you talk to some really nice people.
Okay. Sure. Yeah, right. I'm telling you, Art, there's something fascinating, though, I wanted to tell you about.
Sure.
This last time, I think it would be March 1st. March 1st, late at night.
Yep.
Oh, no, not late at night, I'm sorry. It was only about 9:30 or 10:30 between that time. But I thought it was going to start lightning. I thought I'd seen a couple of flashes. And
yes.
I thought standing in a metal box on a flat plateau is no place to be.
Good point.
Yeah, so I took the phone off the hook, and I get in my van, and I can't sleep. And so I'm just looking out my window. I have these nice big bay windows in my van. I like the sky out there. You know, there's no lighting. You can just see a billion stars.
Actually, I tell people across this country that where I live, you can look and you can see the Milky Way literally from one horizon all the way to the other horizon.
Yes, I know. I've seen it.
Right.
It's incredible. So I'm enjoying the view. And, God, I hope I can describe this right. It's the entrance I need to get right on this. I seen a pinpoint of light. At the second I seen a pinpoint of light, it burst out to the sides. I would say like a lighthouse beacon.
Yes.
You know, the light got wider as it went out.
Right.
And it started at the point. But I mean, the point and the flash were milliseconds apart.
Uh-huh.
And I just, what the hell is that?
Yeah.
So I get up a little closer to my window and I'm looking at it, and there's nothing. About a minute or two goes by, but I can't take my eyes off of it.
Uh-huh.
And all of a sudden, I don't want to say it didn't make this sound, but the only way I can describe it is it just popped in the view. And there it was. I mean...
Well, there what was?
Okay. It has a yellow light on top. I've seen this before at a beach called McCurver's Beach. I mentioned it briefly in my journal on my website. I'd like to go into more detail.
Oh, you have a whole journal on your website.
Yes, I have a journal of just my adventures out there in the desert, but I touched briefly on an incident at a beach called McCurver's Beach. It was a very, very intense incident. It was the same light. It was the same light this time, except it was so close I could see actually more than a light. This was the very first time, Art, I have ever seen a solid structure. I've always seen, you know,
oh,
a
heard
light.
You. So it was more than a light. You actually saw a V.
It was close enough.
Oh, my.
It was zigzagging toward me, and I'd like to go into more detail about what was in my mind and all that.
Here, let me imagine what might be in your mind. I mean, you're 24 miles or whatever from anything.
Yes.
And you're all alone, and it's nighttime, and it's dark, and here comes this thing toward you. I mean, you could imagine being, I don't know, disemboweled and left in the desert like a gutted cow.
Well, you know, actually, Art, you know, I'm not worried about that because of past experiences. I kind of knew what they were there for, and I hope I don't sound like a nut, but I kind of knew what was going to happen.
I asked
for it, and then I decided I changed my mind, and it left me alone. But it zigzagged.
So you wished it there?
Oh, from... I've seen it before, and
now there are
really
those.
Tired of
there are those, Chad. They would say two things: one, that you were a victim of exposure; that you had been out in the desert sun and cold too long, and you began to hallucinate.
I wouldn't buy that though.
You wouldn't buy that?
No.
There are also many who would say that you take alcoholic refreshments out there with you.
Actually, New Year's Eve, I took 5 bottles of champagne. Other than that,
five?
I really don't drink much alcohol.
Excuse me? 5 bottles?
Yes.
Did the people understand what you were saying on the phone at all?
Actually, I got really crazy on the phone. I got to get a little carried away a little bit. I was trying to talk women into taking their shirts off and stuff. I mean, it wasn't going to do me any good. I couldn't see them, but just getting a kick out of it.
How many of them did?
Actually, 4 or 5 said they did. Only one of them I truly believed. And one girl called me up, and I had phone sex on the phone out there, and that was weird. Some girl called me up. She heard I was in the desert, and she, like, was trying to give me phone sex or something.
Really?
Yeah. It's very interesting.
Well, I guess you're going to run into all of it out there because people have really strange motives. I mean, for another thing, aren't you a little bit afraid of... here you are... I mean, you tell people basically where you are, right?
When I go there?
Yeah.
I just tell people I'm going to the desert and there's a phone booth, but no one, I really never took anybody except...
No, I mean, when somebody calls you on the phone and they say, I've heard this is a phone booth out in the middle of the desert, out in the middle of nowhere, where is it really? Do you tell them, right?
Oh, yes, I describe the surroundings and they're just blown away.
Well, suppose somebody were to decide to come and actually see you, meet you.
Well, here's Art. This is great. I want to tell you about this. If we can go into detail some other time about this, what this sighting I had came, because it really wobbled really bad and it came up close by the van. But I want to get into that. But let me tell you about this because you're gonna love this. Talking about people coming to meet me.
Yeah.
3 guys from New York City called me 2 days before New Year's Eve, and they've been calling the booth for 6 or 7 months. No one ever answered. I answered. We ended up talking for about 20 or 30 minutes, and before the conversation ended, the guy goes, you know, Chad, I think I'm going to come out there and visit you. I'm going to fly into Vegas, rent an SUV, and let's have a party New Year's Eve. I said, sure. 3 guys from Vegas called, told me the same thing. I said, sure. A couple from Santa Barbara? Sure. A couple from Michigan? Okay. A couple guys, somewhere in Southern California. Before I knew it, Art, I was being descended on, you know, New Year's Day Eve by people. I had like 40 people. I had to dig another fire pit.
What? You mean they actually came out?
All right, they came out. I was standing on the phone talking to Germany or something, and this little rental jeep comes up, and this guy opens the door and says, "Are you Chad?" I said, "Yeah." He goes, "I'm Nick from New York. I talked to you the day before yesterday." I said, "Son of a bitch." And I'll tell you, Art, it was amazing because I started to worry because no one knew each other, and we were miles from any kind of help. And I'm thinking, there's alcohol, it's New Year's Eve. What if there's a personality clash here?
Yeah.
What is going to happen? And you know what? No worries. That phone booth seems to only draw a certain type of person. I figured that out. Out of everybody that's passed my way up there.
You mean it's like there's a profile for a person who...
They are all extremely cool, laid back, respect the landscape, the booth, what's going on with it. Respect the overseas callers. Don't be a jerk to them, you know.
Be a good American.
Exactly.
Even
though, Art, these guys from Iran, let me tell you something about this.
You got calls from Iran?
I can't even say the word on radio, but there's this guy. He gets me all the time. And I don't let him get me riled on the phone, but sometimes I'm getting a little sick of him. I don't know how he gets through so many times, but he tells me all these nasty things about my mother, and in the background I hear these guys screaming, "Down with America, down with America."
He insults you?
Oh, yeah, he insults me beyond all belief, and I try to kill him with kindness, and finally he gets so mad at me because I'm just so nice, he hangs up. But finally I got so fed up with Art, he called, and I recognized his voice right over the way. I said, "You know what, buddy? Bill Clinton's coming over to kick your ass." He said, "What?" I go, "I'm sending my president over there. I'm tired of you." And then I hung up on him. And you know what? That's the only caller I've ever hung up on.
So, in other words, normally you don't hang up on
me. I never hang up on anybody. I talked to a lady in Canada who was 62 years old. She was a shut-in. She had back surgery. She was on morphine. Her family neighbor came and visited her. I talked to her for an hour and a half. Yep. We traded emails, and I stay in touch with her.
Do you have a family?
I have a family, but I rarely see them. I just have a couple of sisters that live about 60 miles away from me, and I live with some friends.
So your parents are not alive?
No, neither one.
Your sisters are, though?
Yes. I just see them on holidays.
I take it that you've at least told your sisters what you do?
Oh, yeah. They don't. Every time I leave the house, they can't believe what I'm going to do. When I came back from Japan, they could not believe, what I told them I did over there. It was just surreal.
Yeah, I have some Japan stories myself.
Yeah.
It's awesome. And anyway, but they don't think you're unbalanced.
They joke about it. They say, you must have a chemical imbalance in your brain or something. But, I have a good time. And I don't worry about what other people... If you go through your life worrying about what other people think about you, you're going to be an old man and you've never done anything you really want to do because you're worried about what another human being is going to think of you.
You're right. Oh, no, you're right.
Yeah, you can't live like that.
I think what you do is cool. Now, I can have Keith... I'm going to give your website out here again.
Sure.
And I can have Keith put a link up to it. Now, is the... In addition to photographs of the phone booth, the phone number is there also?
The phone number is on my opening page, yes.
All right. Your website is members.zoom. That's XOOM. .com/DesertChad/
That's right.
That's correct?
That's correct.
Okay, well, we'll have Keith get a link up to that. And again...
I'm going to be adding a lot more. I've got a short little 3 or 4 minute video. I take three calls.
What?
One guy calls to order a pizza, and he's not joking, Art. He thinks he called a place to order a pizza. And then I took a call from Scotland and a call from France, and I got it on a little video.
You have all this on video?
Yes.
And did you manage to tape the voices of the people calling, or just...
Actually, I haven't been able to do that. I'm involved in a film crew found me one night when I was up there after I was
filmed.
A film crew from LA came up to shoot a short documentary on the loneliest phone booths on the planet. they pulled the art. Listen to this. It's like 1 in the morning. I'm out in the middle of nowhere. I got a sleeping bag over my head. I got 3 candles lit, and off in the distance, because you can see, miles away.
Oh, yeah.
I see these lights coming toward me, and I'm thinking, my God, I'd rather have aliens than humans coming at me right now. I'd feel safer, Who drives in the middle of the desert at this time of night? Are they dumping a body out? Are they seeing my candles? I'm blowing out candles.
Yep.
I still can't let go of the phone. I'm talking to this girl in Germany. They pull up. It turns out the LA film crew, they look at my journal, my phone log. They look at me. And they find out what I've been doing out there. Now I'm in this independent film and they shot a bunch of footage of it, and it's just.
Are you going to be in some sort of a A&E special or something?
I believe it's going to be released at Sundance next year.
At the Sundance Film Festival?
Yes.
So, then you're sort of a living urban legend.
I guess, because they came back up and shot more footage of me since I've been up there again. And I think the director's flying into San Francisco next Thursday.
What? So there could be Desert Chad the movie.
Yeah, and they're interviewing some of the callers that actually got through and talked to me, some of the overseas people.
Oh, you mean they actually fly? They're going to fly and talk to these people and
I don't know if they're going to... some of the people are actually coming here. I got a kid in Germany who I cannot believe this. He is. He calls me on my cell phone while I'm at work. He's getting his plans together. He's trying to get a credit card that he can use in America.
Huh.
He's coming. He met me at the phone booth, Art. This kid called me at the phone booth. He got through a couple times, and now... He wants to come visit me and wants me to take him up there. I said, sure, you know, I'll take you up there.
So, to all the people who would say, you're crazy as a loon, you have too much time on your hands, you need to get a life, you would say what?
I have a life. I'm having a great time.
Well, Desert Chad, my friend, you're my kind of guy. I appreciate your coming on the air with me tonight.
No problem.
I wish I could have gotten you at the booth.
Next time I'm going to let you know ahead of time when I'm going to go.
Would you do that?
And maybe we can arrange a time, and I'll just keep the call short, and you maybe just keep trying, and you'll get through.
That's all I can do is keep trying.
That's all I can tell anybody to do, yeah.
All right. Desert Chad, thank you.
You're welcome.
And get some sleep.
I'll try.
All right. Well, there it is. Not an urban legend, but really the real thing. Crazy Desert Chad, who sits out in the middle of nowhere and answers phone calls from all over the world. I'm Art Bell, and this is Coast to Coast AM.
When the wind blows, well, Jack be nimble, Jack be quick. Jack jumps over the candlestick. He jumped so high up above, he landed in the cradle of love. Well, rock-a-bye, baby, in the treetop. When the wind blows.
Call Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
Well, it's all true. Desert Chad's website is linked from our side now, and there are very good photographs of the phone booth out in the middle of nowhere where Chad goes. And I suggest you go take a look. Plus, this is such a catchy tune. You'll find it going through your brain again and again. If you go to the site, the urban legend site that was mentioned, we've got a link up there. You will see the bare-breasted photograph or frame that was referenced in the discussion we had a little while ago. It is one of several, many actually, that are there. But we have the link to that website as well. So there you are. In a moment, we'll begin open lines. Anything you want to talk about, fair game. I've got just a couple of things, but then we'll move to open lines. Well, once again, as far as the gotta wait for the tone. Once again, as far as the elections are concerned, I don't care. You know, if it's come down to Bush and Gore, you know what? I just don't care. Right back to where I was. Any little glimmer of hope that there could be some change, Bradley, maybe McCain, gone. So, it's a nightmare. It's going to be a choice between Bush, who I consider to be, personally, he gives me the creeps. Maybe it's just because he looks so much like his dad, I don't know. And Gore, who will be a continuation, no doubt, of... And, you know, I already know what the campaign is going to be about. Gore took money at a Buddhist temple, right? Going to pound that one. Gore is going to probably draw parallels to the last part of the Bush president. And, you know, the whole thing, oh, man. Here's something kind of interesting, though. This appeared in the Chicago Sun-Times on February 29th. You can believe it or not, but it's true. The headline of the article, Keith, if you want to find it, go find it. It's called Science Turns to Indians. Remember I had a call about this? NASA and the Indians? NASA sure is doing a lot of strange stuff lately. In an unusual marriage of interests, the federal government has turned to Indians to combat one of the greatest environmental challenges of the next millennium, climate change. Oh, my God, you think about that for a minute. The federal government has turned to the American native to fight one of the greatest environmental challenges, according to NASA, of the next millennium, climate change. Hello? The convergence is part of a trend initiated and supported by NASA to incorporate the multi-generational perspectives spanning centuries with NASA scientific data on phenomena such as ozone depletion and rising oceans. NASA scientists' grants and technologies are also supporting American Indians' assessments of climate impact on their homelands. For example, Cornell University's Akwiwan Press has published a double issue of its widely circulated journal, Native Americans, with the help of a $61,000 grant from NASA's Earth Sciences Enterprise Division. Despite centuries of skepticism, the intersection of hard scientific investigation and the views of American Indians is clear, said Verna Taylor, former Pueblo governor and project director for the Native Peoples, Native Homelands Southwest Initiative. Scientists, as she goes on, have always been skeptical, but now we have come full circle. So, there's one that's not an urban legend. If you want to check the story yourself, you go to the Chicago Sun-Times, pull up the story called Science Turns to Indians, February 29th of 2000. Read it for yourself. Now, why, I ask myself, would NASA turn to the American native to find out what's going on with climate change? Well, I had some pretty serious American natives on a couple of years ago. Hopi Indians. Hopi elders, actually. And they said, the change is not coming, Art. It's here. That's why we're on the air with you. And so now, all of a sudden, in a turnabout, a big turnabout, NASA is listening to American natives? A tale from Nebraska from a listener of KFAB 1190 AM in Nebraska, Omaha. Says, good morning, Art. Urban legend, question mark. Somebody is working at a gas station, and one of the regular customers came in with an infected black eye. The cashier asked the customer what happened. The customer said that she went to a strip bar with some friends. They sat near the stage, and she felt something moist hit her face. She wrote it off as sweat from the dancer. When she woke up the next day, her eye was infected. She went to the doctor and found out that a crab had laid eggs in her eye. A crab had laid eggs in her eye. Oh, my God. That's nearly as bad as the Star Trek. Remember the worm in the ear? The crab laying eggs. Oh, can you imagine that? Little guys are getting up and walking. You can feel them even with your lids closed, tromping across your eyeball. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Good morning.
How you doing, Art?
All right, extinguish your radio. Yes. Thank you.
Hey, how you doing? What was that number, that phone number? Because I don't have...
I don't want to give it out on the air.
You don't?
It's on the website.
I don't have the internet.
You know, just in case. I mean, you never know. What if it's some poor old lady in Pasadena or something? It's really a legit phone number, and you can get it on the website.
Darn. All right, thanks.
Oh, you're welcome. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello. Hello?
Hello?
Hello.
Hi.
Shall we dance?
No, thank you. My name is Dan.
Okay, then, let's not dance.
Calling from Washougal, Washington.
Yes, Dan.
I have a question to ask you. Is Michael Collins from Apollo 11 still alive?
I have no idea. I'm sorry. I don't know.
The reason I'm asking, I've been asked by a friend of mine who was on the USS Hornet that retrieved Apollo 11 from the ocean to try and get in contact with him. He has something that belongs to Michael Collins that they were awarded. It's a medallion.
Really?
Yes. And
why is he in possession of that?
Well, that's kind of a long story, I guess.
Give me the shortest version.
Shortest version, he was the crane operator that operated the crane that came and retrieved Apollo 11. And eventually, he was also an artist. He drew a picture of Michael Collins and presented it to him. Or, well, they couldn't have personal contact because they were enclosed in a trailer at the time. Apparently, NASA presented the three astronauts each with a medallion,
right,
commemorating their experience there. And somehow or another, he came into possession of this.
Yeah.
And as years have gone by, he has taken it to heart to get it back to its rightful owner.
Well, I understand that. I wish I had an answer for you. I don't know offhand, but we'll get an answer, I promise you. All right?
Okay.
All right, thank you very much for the call. I wish I knew. There is a story. Now, this may be urban legend. I don't know. It comes from the Times Foreign News. And I suppose you may have heard about this. Vegetarian Antichrist is walking among us now. By Richard Owen in Rome, Italy. Now, the actual title of the article, in case you're going to want to try to look it up, is Vegetarian Antichrist is Walking Among Us. The leading conservative contender to succeed the Pope yesterday said the Antichrist was already on Earth, in the guise of a prominent philanthropist whose concern for human rights and the environment and advocacy of vegetarianism makes his masks his real aim, the destruction of Christianity and the death of God. Well, how could you kill God? Allegedly said by Cardinal Biffi, B-I-F-F-I, 71 years of age, the Archbishop of Bologna, is it? Bologna? I think so. Said the Antichrist was not the beast with seven heads described in the book of Revelations, but a fascinating personality whose outward charm and plausibility had deceived his enemies. God, could he be talking about our president? No. Cardinal Biffi said the Antichrist espoused vegetarianism, pacifism, environmentalism, and animal rights. Huh. Vegetarianism, well, I can't go along with that one. Pacifism, well, who wants to fight? environmentalism, somebody better fight that one, and animal rights. He also identified the Antichrist as an expert on the Bible. Of course he would be. And nevertheless promotes, quote, vague and fashionable spiritual values, end quote, rather than the scriptures. So if this story is true and not an urban legend, then the man thought to be the next pope is saying the Antichrist is here now. West of the Rockies, you are on the air. Good morning.
Hello.
Hello.
Hey, how you doing, Art?
I'm fine.
Okay, this is Ray, and I'm calling from Glendale, California. I'm listening to you on the CC radio, and that's on 780 KKOH in Reno.
Oh, that's a blaster of a station, I'll tell you.
Oh, yeah, I love this radio.
I know. Well, look, it's flat, the best there is.
Damn right.
Yep.
Boy, howdy.
Yep, it is.
Okay, quick question here. When are you going to have Merle Haggard or Willie Nelson back on there?
Well, I got a fax from Merle a couple of weeks ago, and he'd like to come back on, and I'd love to have him back on.
Uh-huh.
So, anytime.
Oh, that'd be great, because that's a good show when he had him on there.
Well, both of them are kind of crazy.
Oh, yeah.
And so they're fun to have on the air. I mean, they're just, you know, there's something about country people, you know. They lead the hard life.
Uh-huh. Oh, and one more thing here. Can you give me that webpage for Desert Chad?
It's on mine. Just simply go to my website, www.artbell.com, and you'll see the link right there.
Oh, it's just...
And you can see the phone booth. He's got pictures of the phone booth and all kinds of cool stuff up there.
Okay.
All right?
All right, have a good one now.
There's one that is not an urban legend. I'll see you later.
All right, Art, thank you.
Bye. First-time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Yeah, this is Will from Glead, Washington.
Will, turn that radio off.
It's off.
Step on it. That's good.
How you doing tonight?
I'm all right.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting about that Desert Wheel. Desert Chad.
Desert Chad, yeah.
Yeah, it's bizarre.
Well, people do strange things, you know?
That is totally weird.
Yeah, but it's kind of, in a weird kind of way, interesting. I mean...
Oh, yeah.
The psychology of both sides, you know, the guy would certainly sit out there in the middle of the desert... You got
to
really wonder about him.
You do anything to get out of the town and get away from all the crazy stuff.
And then you got to wonder about the people who call. But I wonder more about the guy who would be out in the desert, you know, getting sunburned and windblown and all that, just to talk to people.
That or get mutilated from some crazy maniac out there.
Or a light with substance.
All right. Well, I was just calling to tell you how you doing tonight.
That's
say
a
hello
question.
To the world out
you don't
there.
Tell me that. That's a question. How am I doing?
Hard telling. It's up to you.
Thanks for the call.
Yep, later.
See you later. Everybody just automatically asks that. Have you ever noticed? How you doing? And it's just a nicety that people can't stop from doing. But I used to launch into a litany of little aches and pains that I had. Then once I do that, you know, oh, the knee's a little sore, and I've had this upper arm thing for a while, and a little arthritis here in the fingers, you know. Make them sorry they ever asked. Then for about 2 or 3 days, nobody asks. Then they start in again. Wild card line, you're on the air.
Oh, hi, Art. This is Dave from San Jose. Great show, by the way.
Hey, Dave.
That article on science turns to Indians.
Yes.
You're going to have a tough time getting it off the Chicago Sun-Times website because they don't list all their articles. But if you look at the bottom of that article, because I had to fax it right from the paper.
Oh, you're the one who faxed it to me.
Yeah, here
it is. Okay, it says the fall-winter 1999 double issue of the Native American Journal can be viewed on the AKWECKON
right.
Press link of the American Indian Program website.
And there's the website address as follow. Did that come through on the fax?
It's hard to read.
All right, I'll fax those two over.
It's at Cornell, though, huh?
Yeah, exactly.
So it's a real story. I mean, a lot of people just wouldn't believe this.
Oh, no, but I was trying. Yeah, I know I was trying.
Why would NASA go to the American Native to try and figure out what's going on with climate change?
Obviously, they know something, or they don't know what's... They have seen something, and they don't understand it. Because
yep.
If you look in that article...
Boy, do I agree.
You'll see that Handsome Lake prophecy.
Yep.
That says, you know, the maples will start dying, you know...
Yes.
NASA, you know, is observing all of
it. Says Handsome Lake said, they said the maple tree leader of all trees will begin dying from the top down.
Yep.
And nobody knows how to deal with it. So what you're saying is true. In other words, NASA has run into an obvious brick wall with regard to climate change, which no longer can be explained by saying La Nina,
right.
El Nino,
right.
or any of those things.
Right.
It's changed way beyond that already, and they damn well know it.
Mm-hmm.
And they can see it and document it, and they can't explain it.
Because there is no way they would go to the publicly.
I agree.
They would never. That's the worst PR move you could ever make.
Oh, I couldn't agree more with you. And it's saying something about NASA's going through some kind of change.
Yep, something's up there. Unless they're just so completely dumbfounded that they have to find someone to help them out. Obviously, right?
I would say this is the rough equivalent of a police department with a murder they cannot solve,
right.
picking up the phone and calling a psychic.
Right, you mentioned that last week, and that was a great metaphor. It's the same thing.
So
that Antichrist story, that's from the Times of London. That's a fairly legit paper. That he's from Bologna, by the way, which is in Italy. That Biffy, he's like the number two man in the Vatican.
Could be the next pope.
That's what for him to come out and say that, I almost fell off my chair when I read that. It's incredible.
Well,
anyway.
Well, I have always heard that the Antichrist would fool us. In other words, that he would appear to be a good, caring, loving
right.
being and all that sort of stuff.
Right, because he mimics Christ. He mimics, anti is really not, it is against, but it also means instead of. So he mimics,
Yeah.
And then traps you in.
Well, it'll be something
all
if
right,
this
sir.
Man is made pope. I don't know. Animal rights people are going to be accused. All the environmentalists, and they're all going to be accused of harboring the Antichrist.
There's a great BBC News article on the glaciers melting if you want to check your facts.
All right, I'll take a look at it.
Yeah.
I don't need to, though. I know what's happening. The climate is changing, and apparently even NASA doesn't know why. I'm Art Bell. This is Coast to Coast AM.
From west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. The wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. And to reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Networks.
Richard Roeper said I was an urban legend. Am I really an urban legend? I've been thinking about that, and that would mean that I'm not real. But then again, I'm sure many of you have thought that for a long time now. Right? I'm sure of it. Anyway, more unscreened open lines coming right up. Okay, well, you were... Hey, here's a couple of items that might make you scratch your head. Tens of thousands of flamingos on central Kenya's Lake Bogoria have died since July of an unidentified illness. They, of course, suspect pollution. Thousands of flamingos. And then this item. And I don't know what you want to read into this, and I'm not sure what I read into it, but if you believe that we evolved from the simian class, you might get something out of this, or maybe not. Headline, drought attack. A group of thirsty monkeys in drought-stricken Kenya are reported to have stoned a shepherd to death as he was watering his cattle. Ali Adam Hussein stopped in the northeastern district of Wajir to water his livestock at a pond when the monkeys attacked him by throwing stones. The East African Standard reported that Hussein was taken to a clinic in the city of Ajawa, but later died of severe head injuries, according to a nurse in that community. It was not known what type of monkeys were involved in the attack. However, baboons are notorious for throwing objects when angered. But you know what's not said here? What if they were trying to kill him for food? Do you remember the movie 2001? Do you remember the obelisk? Do you remember what happened right after the obelisk? Do you remember the ancient man picking up a club and clubbing another? The use of weapons, the first use of tools? What if these monkeys in Kenya are beginning to undergo some kind of change consistent with a not creation? And I'll just leave it at that. On the international line, whoops, you would have been on the air. We missed you. Sorry about that. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Good morning, Art. How you doing?
I'm doing all right, sir. You must be in a truck.
Yes, I am.
All right. It's noisy, but go ahead.
Yeah. Is this guy for real that was on there tonight?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And if you doubt it for 1 second, if you're referring to the phone booth guy...
Yes.
Go to his website. He's got all the photographs up there, and you can get the telephone number and call it yourself.
Okay, I think I'll check this out. Sounds interesting.
Well, it is, and I don't know why it's interesting. It's like a study in human nature.
Okay, I think I'll go check that out. Is that on your website, too?
Yeah, we've got the link up there right now.
Okay.
Hey, have you got a good air horn on that thing?
Yeah, but my partner's asleep.
All right.
I'd blow it for you, but I didn't wake him up.
Wouldn't want to be responsible for that. Thanks for the call.
Okay, thank you.
See you later. International Line, you're on the air. Hello.
All right, Art.
Yes.
Good, I just got you.
Yes, you just got me.
I just ran out of rings there, and I got you back.
Oh, okay, good.
Chris in Edmonton, Alberta.
Edmonton, yes, sir.
All right. I was just looking on the map here, and directly due south of you is that approximate location about 70 miles just off of Baker.
You're talking about the phone booth.
Desert Chat.
Oh, I know. It's not that far from me. I'm out here in the serious desert, cactus country, folks.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to stop by there one day.
Huh?
Got a nice videotape of our Canadian singer up here. What's his name? Gord. My mind's stumped right now.
That's right.
Anyways, I can drop that down there for you when I drop by there. What I wanted to know was, do you remember if he said it was south of Interstate 15? There's a recreation area called Providence.
I had the sense that he didn't want to tell us exactly where it was, and I don't blame him.
There's one little bit of irony there.
What?
There's an area possibly in and around there called Devil's Playground.
Well, instead of orange spheres, if he saw a pair of red eyes coming at him, man, what would you do 20-some miles away from any road where there'd be humanity? That'd be it. You'd be gone. You'd be devil's food.
All right.
Devil's
Thanks
food.
Very much.
Yeah, you're welcome very much. First time caller line, you're on the air.
Hey, Art.
Yes.
Man, I got through.
Yes, you did.
You're kind of like Desert Chad in a way.
In a way, good. I know.
Getting all these calls from us strange night owls.
I know.
Urban legends.
Yes.
The New Jersey Devil. Did your guest touch on that at all?
No, but you know... I'm not so sure that's an urban legend.
It's got to be one of the longest lived ones.
Yeah, there probably really is a Jersey Devil. I kind of questioned that when I first heard it, too, but I had too many people call me with real stories.
Really?
Yeah.
Anything recent?
As a matter of fact, yes. You know, within the lifetime of the caller, I mean, that's recent.
Well, yeah, I'm thinking
it's
like...
It's not like the Jersey Devil died off a long time ago, and now there's just old stories about him floating around.
Well, he seems to keep regenerating or coming back to life. I was on a web page devoted to the devil, and he's been shot with a cannon, and they found him burned, and he just keeps coming back. But they seem to speculate that the sightings are most often right before a large war, so I'm thinking recent would be like before the Gulf War.
Yeah.
Anything, you heard anything like that?
No, that's the first I've heard of that.
I'm also checking out Chad's website.
Have you seen the pictures of the phone booth?
Yeah. Who in the world would put a phone booth there? Would they think that was going to be a boom area or something?
Well, according to Chad, there was apparently a mine up there a long time ago. The part I liked was, I mean, all the glass is out of it, right?
Yeah.
And the phone company sent somebody up to replace the old dial phone with a brand new push-button phone. Can you imagine the phone guy who had to go up there and do that? He's probably shaking his head saying, these maniacs I work for?
Probably took them longer to find it than it did to change the phone.
Well, they must have had a map made out, you know, or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
But he must have thought his bosses were out of their minds.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, I'm Dago Dave from Phoenix, Arizona.
All right. My friend, is it still raining there? I saw there was a low that was sitting over Phoenix. It was like God said, rain on Phoenix and keep raining.
Yeah, it rained for about 2.5 days and then cleared up today.
Uh-huh. Well, y'all behave yourselves or that'll happen again.
Nah, not going to behave ourselves.
I'll see you later.
Bye.
Bye. Wild Card Line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi, this is Adam.
Adam.
Oliver, Missouri.
Not the Adam.
Yes.
Wow, you're actually the Adam?
Oh, yes, I am. And I'm very old.
Wow. This is an honor.
No, I'm just Adam. Plain old Adam.
You're not, like, picking pieces of apple out of your teeth?
No. I dumped Eve, man. She's trouble.
Right on.
Well, anyway, as long as we're raking Disney through the mud, I thought I'd...
We were not... Now, just one cotton-picking minute. We were not raking Disney through the mud. We were exposing nasty, nasty urban rumors that as false, that have been said about Disney.
Oh, man.
Let's be fair here.
I was thinking of becoming an animator at one point in time. We're sick.
Well, you know, even animators need a little comic relief every now and then.
Yeah, I know. I know some twisted people. Well,
oh, you do? So, in other words, you work with twisted people?
Yeah.
So they do things like that?
Yeah, we're bored. We got a lot of time.
You're like programmers who put in little dead man switches and stuff like that in the software they write. It's about the equivalent of that.
Yep. Well, anyway, I thought this is actually pertaining to the voice actor who played Aladdin.
Aladdin, yeah.
Aladdin, and during a scene where he lands on the balcony on his magic carpet or whatever,
yeah.
Right before, I believe, a tiger growls at him, and he says, I can't be sure, but I think it's all teenagers take off your clothes. Have you ever heard of that?
No.
It's there. I've seen it. I've shown it to a bunch of people.
I mean, just in plain English?
Yeah, but it's very, it's slurred in there. It's very quick.
All teenagers take off your clothes. All teenagers take off your clothes.
It's audible. You can hear it if you actually...
Well, that's audible. All teenagers take off your clothes.
Well...
Is it like that?
Yeah, if you got it, you ought to check it out because, man, that is freaky. And, you know, that's voice acting. That's all pre-edited. I mean, they have people in the studio recording this.
You're certain this is not another urban legend?
No, this is well known.
Well, I didn't know it.
I heard it from somebody else. It's in there.
Maybe it's only well known among animators and people on the inside like yourself.
Well, this was not an animator. This is just somebody I knew.
No, I understand. But I mean, you'd be tight with the voice guys too, right? And so somehow you'd hear about it.
Right. Well, another suggestion, if I might.
You might.
Have you ever interviewed Hunter S. Thompson?
No.
You know who he is, right?
No.
Okay, he's the Gonzo journalist.
The Gonzo journalist.
Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
That was a terrible movie. I thought Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas was a terrible movie.
He
Oh, no, wait a minute. Maybe it wasn't Fear and Loathing. Was it Fear and Loathing or Leaving Las Vegas? I can't remember.
Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, Johnny Depp.
Yeah, that was the awful movie, wasn't it?
It's a great book, though.
But it was such a dark movie.
Yeah, I'll admit it. His life is a roller coaster.
I mean, that was really dark.
It's all true.
The whole movie was true?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it really happened.
Sheesh. Well, that makes it even sadder.
Yeah, he's still around. He'd be an interesting guest.
I'm open. You know me.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. I'd take a look. Sure, why not? East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hi.
Hey, Art. This is James from Candler, North Carolina.
On a digital cellular phone, right?
If you won't call it that, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, let's do.
West of the Rockies, call toll-free 1-800-618-8255.
Now, don't say that. That's not nice. don't say that. No, stop. Don't say that.
Okay. I'd rather listen to repeats than some of that stuff.
Change subjects.
What about the urban legend of the woman apparently had the Spanish fly and you know the thing with the gear shift thing? I didn't hear that tonight.
Well, that's because it's baloney.
Yeah.
Well, even that's something you got told when you were about 12 or 13 years old. The Spanish fly story, that's a bunch of bull. For one thing, as far as I know, now I'll probably get email on this, but there is no such thing as Spanish fly.
Oh, yeah.
Because if there was, you and I would have had it a long time ago.
Yeah, like Viagra, you know. But when are you going to go back to a full work week?
You'll know soon.
Okay.
All right.
Take care.
All right, take care. There's no such thing as Spanish fly. That is an urban legend. I'm almost sure of it. I mean, there may be something called Spanish fly that's some kind of real substance, but it does not have the effect as described in that story. So quit perpetrating that and promulgating that story. Stop that. All of you. Terrible story. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Good morning, Art. Bill from Gardnerville.
Hello, Bill.
One of your most fascinating guests you had was the fellow that had the hole in the earth that apparently went down forever. Is there
Mel's
any follow-up
hole.
On that?
Mel, yeah, sure there was, and here it is. Mel sent me email and said he was here in the States, and he wanted to come on and give us all an update. He sent that, he sent me one from Australia first, and then one when he actually got here, and I called Mel, and he was supposed to be on the air that night, and when I called his phone, I couldn't get Mel. And so we're supposed to have an update from Mel, and Mel, if you're out there, come on, buddy, you promised and bailed out on me. So one can only imagine that the forces moved. I mean, my phones are monitored.
Well, I tell you, that was a fascinating story, and I kind of hope that it's true. It's kind of great.
Well, it has every possibility of being true. I mean, a television a news crew went up there and found military boot prints and all kinds of things, and rumors of the hole, and, you know. So it's got every reason, every possibility of being true.
Just amazing. Art, I, like you, collect stories on time travel. Have you ever seen a movie called Time Rider?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
I've seen all time movies.
Well, I was hoping I had one that you hadn't seen.
No, it was a great movie, too. I've got a copy.
Well, we'll look forward to hear from Mel.
All right,
thank you.
And maybe we will. First time caller line, you are on the air. Hello.
Hi, Art. This is Mark calling from Little Shoe, Wisconsin.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was wondering about that desert chatter or whatever, and I'm wondering how the heck that ringer even keeps running, you know. Did you think it'd wear out, that ringer on the phone, you know?
Well, listen, the phone company makes their payphones like tanks.
They might.
In fact, have you been to a phone booth recently? They don't even have a cord anymore. They've got a like a metal thing over the cord so you can't cut the cord.
Oh, okay.
And they're built like tanks.
Really? Wow.
Because the phone company knows what people do to phones.
Oh, yeah, and you can rip them right off the hooks or you won't ever know.
Well, you get angry right at the person you're talking to and you bang the phone.
You bet.
So you abuse a phone like I'm abusing mine right now. Probably won't even work anymore.
You're there, man. Yeah, I had an idea for, like when he goes back up there in a couple weeks or whatever, as maybe if he could call you a collector or something like that, or...
Call me?
Yeah.
Now, the odds of him getting through to me are a lot poorer than my getting through to him.
Well, I was thinking maybe if you give your private number, maybe you don't want to do that, huh?
Well, I've got a private home number, but,
Oh, I didn't know how you...
No, otherwise all I have is lines that go on the air here.
Because I figure, you know, since it's on the web now, it's probably going to be impossible to get through now, you know. On his website, you know. I just thought I'd shoot out an idea or something for you.
Yeah. He's an interesting character. I mean, you got to give him credit.
Oh, yeah, he's pretty dedicated, you know, for that kind of, you know, the kind of weather and giving up his, you know, his work and stuff like that.
Dedicated is one word, one phrase.
Yeah.
Well, see, I'll tell you what I got. I've got his cell phone number.
Oh, yeah, we do, okay.
Yeah, so in other words, the next time he's out there, I could probably call the cell phone number and have him terminate a call with some luscious lady in Paris and get through.
That's what I was thinking about too early when I was coming home from work, yeah.
Actually, I'd probably be crazy enough to go out there and take a few calls and see what's going on. It sounds like kind of like fun.
Yeah, that ain't very far for you to go, I bet.
No. Listen, my program is over. I must go. We must go. They'll take us away if I don't. So tell everybody good night.
Hey, good night, American, and good night, Chad.
That's right. That's it, folks. That's all there is for tonight. See you tomorrow night. Same time, same station, and all of that. From the high desert, I'm Art Bell. Good night.